In this world, when a person is born, they are bestowed with a profession by the God of light and a skill by the God of darkness. If you receive a profession that matches your skill, you can train and acquire greater potential for advancement. However, one can only receive a single profession in their lifetime. In other words, when someone is born, their fate is already unfairly sealed. Ayn, who was given the profession of an appraiser, is always looked down upon by others. In this role, when entering dungeons, he has to undertake grueling tasks. Jolene, a member of Ayn's group, watches as their teammate Zoid laughs and remarks that compared to them, Ayn is just trash. Ayn secretly curses those with superior professions for acting like they rule the world. Professions are categorized into three types. Combat-capable professions like swordsmen and magicians are considered elite. Professions like farmers and miners, lacking such abilities, are referred to as common. Commoners often inherit their professions from their parents. Since professions are hereditary, it's likely that a farmer's child will also become a farmer. These children learn similar skills to their parents, following in the family footsteps for a peaceful life. However, there's another path for these children, becoming adventurers. Adventurers earn a living by accepting missions to slay monsters and then harvesting useful materials from them. The main goal of the job is to discover valuable items and change their fortunes overnight. Ayn is forced to become an adventurer because his parents died when he was very young, and the family business came to an end. Currently, inside the dungeon, Zoid, after killing a monster, scolds Ayn for being too slow in appraising. He continues to berate Ayn, claiming that if it weren't for a genius like him, Ayn wouldn't be able to kill any monster. Jolene, standing by, says the two of them risked their lives to protect Ayn, so he should be more grateful to them. Ayn resignedly accepts their words as truth. All he can do is pick up monster corpses, destined to scavenge through trash for life. Regardless of what they say, scavenging through trash is all Ayn can do to survive. On their way out, Zoid suddenly exclaims that they are in luck, having found the corpse of a dungeon hound killed by someone else. Ayn was not blinded by materialism and felt something odd about the dungeon hound's corpse, it didn't seem to belong there. Both Zoid and Jolene cheerfully approached the corpse, only to discover another one. Ayn, increasingly fearful, reminded them that this path wasn't on the map. Zoid, refusing to listen to Ayn's warnings, threatened to fire him and withhold his pay if he didn't comply. Ayn, knowing no one else would accept someone with his useless profession, had been overjoyed when he joined the group. With no other choice, he reluctantly followed them deeper inside. They were greeted by a horde of dead dungeon hounds and another pack, fierce and bloodthirsty, eyeing the trio. Ayn realized that this was the aftermath of a battle for food. The others decided to paralyze Ayn and leave him behind as they escaped. Jolene, before leaving, coldly stated she didn't want to die. Zoid mocked Ayn, saying the paralysis wouldn't last long, maybe his grandparents would arrive in time to save him. Despite Ayn's protests, they didn't turn back and even blocked the only exit. Ayn, refusing to die, ran in the opposite direction and found himself at the edge of an abyss. Thinking he'd rather die on his own terms, he jumped. Incredibly, the next morning, Ayn woke up unharmed beneath a tree. He guessed he had fallen onto this tree but miraculously wasn't injured. At that moment, the wheel of fate began to turn for him. Below the abyss stood a majestic ancient tree, and Ayn's life was about to begin anew here. Ayn used his appraisal skill to check the water he was sitting near. He discovered it was Yggdrasil's dew, a restorative item capable of healing all wounds and diseases. Yggdrasil, of which only 9 exist in the world, provides a vast amount of mana globally and can grow rapidly without sunlight. Ayn marveled at the discovery of a real Yggdrasil. In the world he knew, a Yggdrasil had existed but was believed to have withered long ago. However, even after its withering, mana continued to be produced. To uncover the reason, many extensive searches were conducted, but despite relentless efforts, it remained undiscovered. Ayn was astonished to find the Yggdrasil hidden in a cave for such a long time. He approached and touched the tree, grateful for being saved by it. After touching it, everything around him began to shake, which he initially thought was his imagination. Currently, Ayn had no idea how to return to the surface. However, it seemed there were no monsters in this area. Pessimistically, Ayn assumed he wouldn't be rescued, especially not by those who used him as bait. Eventually, he decided that if he had to die of starvation here, so be it. He thanked the tree for saving his life and then turned to leave. The area was still uncharted by the association, so Ayame knew it could be home to monsters far more dangerous than hellhounds. He told himself to stay calm, despite being terrified, and trust in his own abilities. After a large detour, Ayame realized there were fewer monsters than he expected. Just as he thought he might escape, he heard someone crying for help not far away. Ayame assessed that the creature attacking the person was a gremlin, a monster that lived in labyrinths, with low attack power but high speed. It used scythes to attack its prey. Terrified, Ayame realized this monster was way out of his league. It turned its attention to him after dealing with the other person. Ayame was attacked and, despite knowing about the enemy, he had no strength to fight back. Suddenly, the gremlin stopped its attack, and Ayame, bewildered, watched as a death bear approached, a creature powerful enough to shatter the labyrinth itself. With a single blow, it defeated its opponent. Ayame, thrown against the wall by the bear, couldn't see anything. Injured and blinded, he then heard a woman's voice. A beautiful woman appeared and attacked the bear, saying she was asked to help and it wasn't common for her to transport people. After a while, Ayn's vision returned, and he saw the beautiful girl in front of him. The voice he had heard earlier, now identified as the woman's, told him he better use tea and be grateful to her daughter for the rest of his life. Ayame looked at them, confused about what had happened, as he was on the brink of death and had lost his sight just moments ago. After Ayame finished his tea, the woman revealed that she was helping him on behalf of her daughter, Yuri, whom Ayame thanked. He asked if she was Yuri's mother, and she replied that her name was Ursula, and she could be considered Yuri's mother. She was also the guardian of Yggdrasil. Her duty was to protect Yuri, who was the Yggdrasil itself, and to watch over the 9 Yggdrasils worldwide to ensure peace. Ursula explained to Ayame, simplifying for his understanding, that Yuri was actually the soul of Yggdrasil. Ayame, in awe, repeated the revelation, commenting on Yuri's beauty. Ursula scolded him, warning him not to look at her daughter, and even hit him on the head. Ayame then asked how his eyes, injured by the death bear, recovered so quickly. Ursula explained that Yuri used a part of her power to create an artificial soul eye for him. She also mentioned that his hand and fingers were reattached by Yuri. Ursula urged Ayame to be grateful to her daughter, who had infused part of her power into his eye for better vision, otherwise, she wouldn't have bothered to help a human like him. Ayame, moved, asked Yuri why she helped him so much. Yuri shyly replied it was because he thanked her. She mentioned that although rare, others have fallen down here, but upon realizing she was Yggdrasil, they broke her branches and plucked her leaves without hesitation. Ursula angrily cursed those people, noting that Ayn's words had made Yuri extremely happy. Ayn approached Yuri to thank her again, calling her his savior. Ursula, annoyed, pulled Ayn away from her daughter and told him it was time to leave since he had been saved. Yuri, looking like she was about to cry, stopped Ursula. She argued that the outside world was too dangerous for Ayn, and if he left, he would surely die. Ayn knew she was right, considering the S-level monsters in the dungeon. If he returned to the dungeon, death would be imminent. Ursula told Yuri that as a guardian, she couldn't go far from Yuri and definitely couldn't escort Ayn out of there. Although Ursula had teleportation magic, she couldn't use it in the labyrinth. Hearing this, Yuri burst into tears, leaving Ursula unsure of what to do. She consoled her daughter, saying she wouldn't be happy if Yuri cried. Touched by her daughter's tears, Ursula agreed to help Ayn escape. Since it had come to this, she decided to train him. Ursula announced that she would train Ayn until he was strong enough to leave. Yuri, stopping her tears, hugged her mother and repeatedly thanked her. Ursula, feeling helpless against her daughter's wishes, didn't refuse. She told Ayn to hurry and bow in gratitude to her daughter. Ursula loudly declared that Ayn would be trained by the oldest and strongest sage. She warned him that if he dared to slack off or run away, she would beat him to death. Ayn, with determination, loudly expressed his reliance on her and silently vowed to survive and leave this place. Ursula's training for Ayn started immediately. Ayn, looking down the dark path, felt his resolve waning. He fearfully asked Ursula if she was serious about starting his training in actual combat. Ursula, unusually patient, explained that if he only sat and learned theory, it would take a lifetime to escape. She chose a shortcut for Ayn, urging him to see the path ahead clearly. Ein looked into the pitch-black tunnel and said he couldn't see anything. Ursula, losing patience, scolded him for his stupidity. She reminded him whose eyes he received. She yelled that Ein was blessed with a piece of Yggdrasil's core, the main energy source of the tree, which Yuri had given to him. Ursula told Ein that his current eyes were vastly different from an hour ago, and his vision must have improved. Despite her explanation, Ein didn't feel any difference. Ursula continued, saying it was because he hadn't realized the full power of the soul eye. She instructed him to start by being extremely vigilant. Ein closed his eyes, recalling the feeling of being torn by the bear's claws, trapped in a world of darkness. However, Yuri brought light into Ein's dark world. Everything he could and would receive was thanks to the light Yuri bestowed upon him. Ein felt warmth in his eyes, and when he opened them again, everything had changed. He exclaimed in surprise, asking Ursula what had happened, as the cave, previously pitch dark, was now as bright as day. Ursula suggested he might have gotten used to his new eyes and declared it was time to start training. Ein was again terrified when Ursula brought forth a gremlin, wondering what he should do. Ursula commanded him to dodge all the creature's attacks, marking the first step of his training. Ein doubted his ability to dodge with such speed. Ursula reminded him of his skill as an appraiser, and that the soul eye was not like normal human eyes. Skeptical, Ein used his appraisal skill on the gremlin, instantly perceiving its attack patterns. It was aiming for his right ear with a scythe at high speed. Caught off guard by his success, Ein was hit by the gremlin. Ursula, seeing Ein in pain, said that he couldn't compare the soul eye to mortal eyes, now he could appraise more than before. After saying this, she sat beside him and poured medicine into his mouth, laughing that training to death was the best way to learn. She assured him that no matter how close to death he got, he would be healed. Ein, recovering from his injuries, wondered if this was too harsh. Ursula summoned the gremlin again, giving Ein no time for idle talk. Ein understood the creature's target but realized he needed to anticipate the timing of its attacks. He remembered that he was looking through a soul eye and, as Ursula said, couldn't treat it like a normal eye. He could appraise it, even appraise the timing of its attacks. Finally, Ein managed to perceive the gremlin's 5-second attack sequence. His next task was to accurately dodge its attacks. He joyfully evaded the gremlin, avoiding an attack for the first time from an S-level beast. Ein vowed to himself to become the world's best at dodging. From that hellish day, he grew increasingly confident about escaping from this place. After a week of training, Ein could easily see the movements of the gremlin. He asked Ursula if she saw that he had mastered dodging. She was satisfied and said it was time to move on to the next step, attempting to kill the gremlin. Ein was shocked, reminding her that his profession didn't include combat skills. Ursula asked if he was stupid, saying the training would make him stronger without needing skills. Ein wondered how he could fight without a weapon. Ursula presented a wooden sword made from a branch of Yggdrasil. Previously, Yuri had asked her mother to give it to Ein, which had surprised Ursula, especially since the branch was special. Yuri had said she wanted to help Ein as much as possible. Ursula loudly told Ein that Yuri had endured pain to break off that branch for him, threatening to punish him if he broke it. Seeing Ein's clumsy attempts with the sword, Ursula scorned him, saying that even if he knew when the enemy would attack, with his current skill, he would never hit it. However, when Ein asked what to do, she didn't answer. Fighting alone for a while, Ein realized the enemy could also read his movements. To overcome this, he needed to read its movements too. Ein forced himself to think beyond human limits, as the eyes of the soul were entirely different from normal eyes. Soon after, he discovered that by combining the soul eye and his appraisal skill, he could see far beyond a normal human's vision. The gremlin's movements seemed like a slow-motion film to him. Ein rejoiced at defeating an S-level monster. Ursula approached, scolding him that it was too early to celebrate and not to get arrogant over a single success. She ordered Ein to kill all the monsters in the area. After a while, the ground was littered with gremlin corpses. Ein asked Ursula how she felt, thinking he had become proficient in counterattacking. Ursula calmly told Ein that it was only possible because of his soul eye. Ursula wanted Ein to use the corpses of the gremlins to appraise their techniques and make them his own. Appraisal allowed him to understand all information about an opponent. In other words, it let him transform all information about an opponent into his own knowledge, even turning it into his personal experience. Ayn followed Ursula's instructions but ended up on the ground, crying in pain. Ursula looked at him and said that although he could copy the monster's movements, his frail body couldn't keep up. She yelled at him to listen carefully. His only task now was to train his body to match the gremlin's speed. Following her advice, Ayn trained relentlessly until his muscles strengthened. Finally, he achieved extraordinary physical strength after long days of training. The training became increasingly harsh over time. During a session, Ayn approached Ursula with a thought. He wondered if he could copy abilities from stronger monsters like the Death Bear to become more powerful. Ursula praised him for his improved thinking but reminded him of the pain he endured copying the gremlin's abilities. When copying an ability, he would be incapacitated for a while. Ayn, puzzled, asked what if he was attacked by the bear during that time. Ursula affirmed that was why he needed to ensure he wasn't attacked, implying that he had to kill the bear first. However, with Ayn's current strength, that was impossible. Ursula, with a grim face, made a decision. She felt terrible but decided to grant Ayn a special ability she possessed for him to copy. Ayn, terrified by Ursula's expression, knew it wouldn't be easy. While he was still pondering, Ursula hit him with a mysterious power. Ayn's hair immediately puffed up and curled like a bird's nest, and he cried out, begging her to spare his hair and asking if it could be restored. Ursula calmly said his overreaction to something as trivial as hair was disappointing. She then explained that the technique she used was the void mind technique. It is a skill that can only be used when chanting or using magic. Normally, using magic takes a lot of time, making one extremely passive in combat. Ayn said it would be amazing to use magic without needing to chant. Ursula praised him for understanding quickly and urged him to copy the void mind technique and fireball spell. Ayn did as instructed but was injured by Ursula's magical power. Somehow, he could only copy the void mind technique. Ursula realized this and then unleashed several fireballs at Ayn. Suppressing his pain, Ayn began to copy. Ursula rarely complimented him, but finally, he managed to copy an offensive technique. Despite this, Ursula still had many techniques for him to copy, and he had to take it step by step. Ayn skeptically asked Ursula why she was suddenly treating him well. Ursula retorted, asking what he meant by his current expression, saying it was because Yuri wanted him to become stronger quickly. Ursula thought to herself that she wasn't doing this just to relieve stress. She then ordered Ayn to stand up and continue copying her wind magic. Ayn was happy to copy these spells but wondered if he was becoming a monster. He doubted his ability to survive this training. It had been 5 days since the magic copying course began. After firing a fireball, Ayn collapsed, exhausted, saying he couldn't take it anymore. Ursula scornfully laughed at his weakness, having only shot 15 fireballs. She said that even if he copied her magic, with his limited mana, he couldn't do much. Magic usage requires mana, and the amount varies based on one's profession. Ayn's profession wasn't related to magic, so he had very little mana. Fortunately, Yuri brought Ayn a drop of Yggdrasil. It not only restored energy but also increased his limits. Ursula pulled her daughter away from Ayn, yelling that even with extra energy, including that from Yggdrasil, his mana wouldn't increase. Ursula continued to order Ayn to use magic until he could see his ancestors, implying that he needed to deplete his mana to the maximum. This way, when he drank the Yggdrasil drop, it would increase even more. But the problem was that increasing his mana limit made him so tired he couldn't stand up. Ursula, pointing angrily at Ayn, scolded him for being foolish, asking if he thought he could defeat the Death Bear with such weak strength. She loudly announced she would train him until he could shoot 1,000 fireballs. Ayn, terrified, looked at Yuri, hoping she would ask her mother to give him a break. This time, Yuri didn't intervene but wished them luck, thinking that if Ayn didn't train, he wouldn't become stronger. Ayn was frightened at the thought of casting 1,000 fireballs, knowing the immense amount of mana it would require. Yuri, understanding his fear, assured him it wasn't much and that he needed to prepare thoroughly. Ursula, satisfied, asked Ayn if he heard her daughter and instructed him to use some intermediate level magic and expend all his mana in one go. Ayn hesitated, aware of the consequences of using high level magic. Ursula, growing impatient, demanded to know if he was going to do it or not. Ayn had no choice but to comply with Ursula's wishes. Fortunately, Yuri was there to restore him. Thus, Ursula's training continued day and night for half a month. Ayn couldn't believe his eyes when he somehow managed to meet Ursula's requirement and shot 1,000 fireballs. Yuri praised Ayn for doing well. Ursula, standing beside, still maintained her attitude as she watched Ayn cry in happiness. With a tremendous amount of mana and the limitless magic he copied from Ursula, Ayn could now easily use various techniques and super praise. Ursula felt it was time to focus on the upcoming revenge battle. Two individuals are currently standing before the death bear that once nearly cost Ayn his life. Ursula asks him what he's worried about, acknowledging that although he's still weak, he has grown much stronger than before. Reluctantly, she admits that Ayn is a quick learner. With the results of his training, she's confident that he will be able to defeat the bear. Ayn silently resolves that it's time for revenge. Ursula watches Ayn launch a fireball and questions whether he truly hasn't mastered magic control yet. Ayn knows he's not a wizard, so his directional skills are poor, and his magic is weak. But if one strike isn't enough, he'll attack repeatedly until the bear is downed. Surprisingly, using the fireball 100 times consecutively proves effective, injuring the bear significantly. Ayn is amazed. Was it always this weak, or has he become stronger? Once the death bear is defeated, Ursula orders him to quickly copy the bear's technique. She casually remarks that she hopes he gains enough confidence to conquer this dungeon. Ayn's next task is to defeat every monster on his path and copy them. The battle with the death bear marks the moment Ayn can return to the surface. Before leaving, Yuri gifts Ayn with the core of the Yggdrasil tree. Ayn declines, grateful for the eye he has received. Ursula insists it's only a loan. If Ayn dies, the core will automatically return to the tree. She implants the core inside Ayn, gradually evolving his artificial eye. Soon, the powers of the Holy Cross soul eye will begin to manifest in him. Yuri, now invisible to Ayn, speaks to him. Ursula explains that Yuri's soul core has been transferred into his artificial eye. In essence, his eye is now akin to the Yggdrasil tree, with Yuri residing within it. Yuri assures Ayn that she will heal him and that he can use as many Yggdrasil drops as he wishes, promising to protect him. Ursula is furious, unable to believe she must entrust her daughter to a mere human. Yuri has always been with her since birth, always isolated because she couldn't make friends with anyone. All humans who come here are trash, always breaking branches off Yuri once they learn she is Yggdrasil. But Ursula feels differently about Ayn compared to other humans who have come before. Deep down, she thinks it will be alright to entrust her daughter to him. She tells Ayn that he may be a fool, but he has the soul of a good person. With his eye, she wants her daughter to see the vast world out there. Ursula generously bestows upon him infinite magic storage and a sword made from the Yggdrasil tree, provided by her daughter. She reminds Ayn that it's time for him to leave. Ayn first tells Yuri to quickly go inside his eye, as it's dangerous outside. Thanks to the Philosopher's Stone, he can communicate with Ursula from a distance. However, Ayn is still not used to having a voice in his head. Ursula has already mapped out a route for him to the exit. All Ayn needs to do is follow the arrows to avoid getting lost. She warns him that in about 5 minutes, he will encounter a giant snake, a huge serpent immune to effects. Seeing Ayn's fearful reaction displeases her. Since she can't punish him directly, Ursula creates annoying clinking sounds in his head to torment him. Ayn is not angry, realizing it's better to have Ursula's guidance to use the eye safely. She scolds him to stop pondering and prepare for battle. She has already copied the route to attack monsters with magic for him, all he needs to do is fight. Ayn marvels at how useful the eyes are, allowing him to know information before meeting an opponent and strike first. Ursula reminds him that he should be grateful to Yuri for life. The giant serpent is now approaching, its immense size slightly panicking Ayn. But with Ursula's help, things become easier. Ayn whispers how incredible it feels to see an S-ranked beast flee in fear. Somehow, defeating an S-ranked monster has become too easy. Ursula allows Ayn some time to be proud, helping him copy the serpent's technique. She informs him that he will acquire immunity and acid use techniques. Only after Ursula's announcement does Ayn remember to stop the action. He's still not ready to endure pain. Strangely, at this moment, Ayn doesn't experience the pain like before. Yuri tells him she has healed him. Ayame is relieved, knowing that from now on, he won't have to endure pain when copying techniques. The two continue their journey until they encounter a large door that forces them to stop. Ayame looks at the door and asks Ursula if he really must go through it. A voice in his head starts, saying if he can't get through here, he shouldn't dream of reaching the surface. Ursula informs him that every dungeon has a boss, and the dungeon itself is a living entity. It lures humans in, and its heart is the core of the dungeon. However, this heart is vulnerable, so it needs a guardian for protection. Thus, the boss is essentially the dungeon's guardian. Ayame believes, with Yuri and Ursula's help, he has become strong enough to defeat S-ranked beasts. But they are nothing compared to this dungeon's boss. Understanding Ayame's concerns, Yuri reassures him that everything will be okay. At this moment, Ayame realizes he is no longer a mere scavenger, he must win. Ursula reveals that the boss is a giant S-ranked golem. Though it's slow, Ayame must be wary of its continuous powerful attacks. She advises that, due to the significant size difference, it's better for Yuri to stay inside Ayame's eye. Ursula continues to warn that in 2 seconds, an attack will be directed straight at him. Ayame is surprised that just by moving, the creature can cause an earthquake. He braces himself to endure the attack, but it's overwhelmingly powerful, like a meteor. Fortunately, Yuri tells him not to worry as she can heal him. Ayame thanks Yuri and reflects that the old him would have been terrified and collapsed, but now he is different. Filled with confidence, Ayame believes he can defeat it. Ayame struggles with the creature for a long time without resolving it, almost getting hit back. He mutters that this beast is ridiculous. This is the true power of a boss monster, he knows it won't be easy to defeat. Ursula, observing the situation, decides to allow Ayame to use the ultimate magic she taught him. Ayame wonders if he can really use it. Ursula had once said that the ultimate magic was too powerful to be used in a dungeon, as it could bury them alive. But she clarifies now that she meant smaller dungeons, this vast space wouldn't pose a problem. She adds that with his current mana, Ayame could only unleash one strike of ultimate magic. But even if he is defeated, Yuri can revive him. With one powerful blow, Ayame completely melts the stone giant. He's in disbelief at what he has just accomplished, staring at the chaotic remnants. Yuri, excited, rushes over and exclaims that he managed to defeat a massive monster. Ayame knows that this would have been impossible alone and thanks Yuri, patting her head. Ursula, impatient, asks Ayame when he plans to copy the skills. In this copying process, Ayame acquires numerous defensive skills, which had always been his weakness but are now restored. Ursula informs him that there's still one thing left to copy, the dungeon's flaw. Ayame turns to see Ursula beside him and is surprised, asking why she's here and not protecting the Yggdrasil tree. She explains that the thing inside his eye has already absorbed 100% of the Yggdrasil's soul core. In other words, Ayame's eye is now just like the Yggdrasil tree, so it's sufficient for her to be beside him. Ursula is interested in the dungeon's core, which is similar to a soul core. Ayame's eye could be strengthened with the dungeon core. Ayame asks her to do it for him, and she instructs him to close his eyes while she works. Ursula mentions that if Ayame defeats many monsters and acquires more dungeon cores, he will become stronger. The final boss is defeated, and Ayame's growing strength is undeniable. All he needs to do now is return to the surface. Ayame curiously looks at the door ahead and asks Ursula if it will automatically close once they leave. He tries to push the door, but no matter how hard he tries, it won't budge. Ursula speculates that when the dungeon's core disappears, this room and the path to the Yggdrasil tree might vanish too. Ursula rarely shows satisfaction, but she smiles contentedly now. This means that no one will be able to approach the Yggdrasil tree ever again. From now on, Yuri can live a peaceful life and witness the world. Ayame understands this and smiles with Ursula, thinking how wonderful that is. Suddenly, he remembers something important and yells out. Ursula, irritated, asks why he's raising his voice now. Ayame loudly reminds her about the hole he fell through, wondering if it's still there. To their surprise, they find that the hole has also been sealed. Ursula calmly states that all paths have been sealed, including that one. Ayame feels relieved and lighter about returning to the surface, excitedly urging them to hurry as freedom is just moments away. Ayame laughs heartily upon seeing the exit right in front of him, where the blue sky, white clouds, and golden sun are visible. Once the excitement settles, Ayame sits down on the grass and wonders what to do next, as he plans to give up being an adventurer. Ursula is curious about why he's abandoning his profession. Ayame shows the monsters he defeated along the way from his storage space, telling them to look. He means there's no longer a reason for him to be an adventurer. Ursula hadn't realized that while finding their way to the surface, Ayame had collected all the monsters he defeated. For Ayame, this was obvious since they were all items dropped by S-ranked monsters. He believes if he sells these, he can live the rest of his life carefree. However, Ayame knows he can't sell everything at once. If the people who knew him as a scavenger saw this, they would suspect theft and he could get caught. Selling them quietly seems to be the best approach. Ayame tells them not to worry about it, as this is why he no longer needs to be an adventurer. Ayame happily suggests to Yuri that they should travel the world, so she can see its vastness. He's been pondering what he truly wants to do during all this time. Ayame asks Yuri, as they travel the world together, what she would like to do. Yuri repeats his question, wondering what she wants to do, to find her answer. Ayame loudly declares that Yuri is his benefactor. For example, if she wants to eat something delicious or see the sea, he agrees to it. Ayame wants to stay with Yuri and help her fulfill her dreams. After some thought, Yuri expresses her wish to meet her family again. Ayame is confused, thinking she already has Ursula, but Yuri clarifies she wants to reunite with her sisters. Ursula explains to Ayame that originally Yggdrasil was a single large tree, but later it split into 9 parts, each part residing in its own dungeon. Ayame realizes that Yuri once lived with her family. He loudly declares their next decision, to travel the world and find Yuri's family. Yuri asks him if he's sure about this, worrying if it will trouble him. Ayame laughs heartily, saying it's not a bother at all and he too wants to meet Yuri's family. Moreover, he is intrigued by the different enemies he might encounter in the dungeons. Ayame's journey continues with a new purpose, to help his benefactor. But first, he needs to meet Zoid and expose his deceit. At a tavern in a village, Zoid is sorrowfully recounting the events that happened to Ayame. A listener expresses a desire to explore the same place. Zoid feigns concern and warns him of the danger. The man laughs, pointing out that Zoid managed to escape and is sitting here. Zoid, feigning distress, says it was all because Ayame told him to leave and stayed behind. The man is surprised that a scavenger like Ayame could say such a thing. Zoid shouts at him not to refer to Ayame that way. He covers his face, pretending to hold back tears, claiming Ayame bravely sacrificed himself to save Zoid and became a shield. In reality, Zoid is secretly smiling, believing only he and Jolene know the truth. He thinks a nobody like Ayame should only serve as bait. Zoid continues to weep to everyone, apologizing for Ayame's sacrifice. Suddenly, Ayame appears next to Zoid, startling him so much that he spits out his drink. Zoid yells, asking why Ayame is still alive and not dead as expected. Ayame calmly replies that, as Zoid can see, he is not dead. He simply defeated the monsters and returned. Zoid angrily yells that Ayame is lying, claiming that defeating so many monsters is impossible for a woman like him. The man standing next to Zoid pulls at his sleeve, asking why he isn't happy that his benefactor has returned. Ayame looks around at everyone and reveals the truth. He was paralyzed by the magic used by Zoid and Jolene and then left for the wolves. Zoid, worriedly looking around, begins to accuse Ayame of slandering him. The man next to him becomes genuinely angry with Zoid, questioning how it's slander. He points out that Zoid himself said Ayame sacrificed for his friends. He further asks why Ayame would lie about the person he just saved. Another person joins in, condemning Zoid for leaving his teammate to die, calling him the real trash. Ayame stops everyone, saying it's enough since he's alive. After leaving a confusing thank you for Zoid, Ayame proudly leaves with Yuri and Ursula. The trio starts their first dungeon exploration on their world tour. Ursula reminds Ayame that the S-ranked Immortal King is the boss of this dungeon. All magical and physical attacks are ineffective against it. She warns him to be careful, as even a light touch could cause an explosion due to the Twin Fire skill. Ayame uses Super Sense on the ghost, followed by a light sword strike. When it counterattacks, Ayame intentionally misses, not hitting the ghost. Ursula scolds him, reminding him that his opponent is a ghost and that magical attacks are useless. Ayame, looking helplessly at her, understands these issues. His previous attack was just a diversion. Just as Ayn said, when the ghost is off guard, he uses the death blow to defeat it. Ayn laughs and tells Ursula that learning this special magic from her was a great choice. A notification board appears, displaying numerous skills possessed by the ghost. Ayn's eyes light up, amazed at the ghost's many skills. After reviewing them all, Ayn tells Ursula he needs to absorb the dungeon's core in the distance. Ursula tells him to kneel so she can assist. After absorbing the energy, Ayn's soul eye is upgraded to level 3. The new skill allows Ayn to understand everything, regardless of time and place. Ayn is excited that he can now understand all kinds of written languages. Their ultimate goal was to find the Yggdrasil tree inside the dungeon, but it seems this isn't the right place. Ursula laughs, saying it was never going to be easy. Yggdrasil, supporting the magic of the whole world, would be a disaster if easily found. Ayn is disheartened, but Yuri cheerfully encourages him not to be sad and to keep going. Ayn realizes that Yuri, who should be more disappointed, is instead worrying about him first. He admires Yuri for being a kind and gentle girl. Ursula jokingly hits Ayn on the head, insisting he should say Yuri is super kind and super cute. After leaving the dungeon, Ayn plans to return to the guild for more information. The people at the center only promise to show them dungeon locations, but it's all lies. Ursula warns that information from the guild is often inaccurate. Ayn thinks they need to go to the royal capital Naiga for more information. But first, he apologizes to Yuri for delaying their reunion. Yuri gently says there's no need to worry, slow and steady is fine. She knows her request was selfish. Ursula gets angry on her daughter's behalf, asking Ayn who he thinks he is to owe Yuri. She urges him to quickly find more valuable information. Ayn is startled by Ursula's frightening expression and promises to wait just 3 seconds. Ursula shouts, questioning how he can check information in 3 seconds. Ayn's shout is even louder than hers. While using appraisal, he sees a carriage nearby being attacked by monsters. Yuri, worried, urges them to hurry and help. On the way, Ursula informs Ayn that the enemy is a beast tamer who can control magical beasts through contracts. There are over 20 kobolds and a dragon waiting above. After observing, Ursula casually mentions that these monsters won't be much of a challenge for him. She points out the dragon is high in the sky and won't see him, advising him to defeat it with electric magic. Ayn follows Ursula's instructions and attacks the dragon in the sky. Soon after, Ursula informs Ayn that it seems he has hit the dragon, and its body will soon fall. Now, Ayn only needs to defeat the pack of kobolds and quickly rescue the attacked people. If he wants to be faster, Ayn can use wide area magic like the sword, but he doesn't want to accidentally hit the civilians. Ayn feels the movements of the monsters slowing down. The S-ranked beasts he fought before moved slowly, but at least they moved. Ursula explains that kobolds are D-ranked monsters, so weak that they seem almost motionless to Ayn. Ayn can't believe these are the same rank as the hunting dogs that attacked him earlier. After defeating all the monsters, the beast tamer appears, angrily asking who Ayn is. Ayn, confused, replies that he's just an appraiser. The man doesn't believe him, saying it's impossible for such a lowly profession to be that powerful. He then smirks, saying it's a pity for Ayn, as he still has another trump card. Ayn asks what else he has besides that chaotic dragon. The man is shocked how Ayn knew about the dragon, and right then, the dragon's body falls. He can't believe his B-ranked dragon was defeated by such a weakling. Ayn laughs, saying if the man had negotiated earlier, he might have spared him. After cornering the man, Ursula calls Ayn over. She tells him that although he doesn't have wings, he can learn to fly from the dragon. Ayn can also learn the water resistance skill from the kobolds. Ayn thanks her and starts copying those 2 skills. Later, Ayn asks Yuri to help the injured people. Yuri tells him to leave it to her. While Yuri treats others, Ayn talks to 2 other calm people nearby. Ayn asks if they are okay. The girl runs over to hug Ayn, proclaiming she has found her hero. She thanks Ayn for saving her from danger. When she was in peril, Ayn swiftly came like the wind to rescue them. Ayn, feeling awkward, looks at the man standing next to her, asking if he's her brother. The man calmly replies that he's just the leader of an exploration group named Jasper, and the girl in front of them is Claudia. At Jasper's mansion, it was Ayn's first time entering such a luxurious house, making him utterly unable to relax. Jasper and Claudia came out to apologize for making Ayn wait for so long. Claudia thanked Ayn profusely for helping them during the monster attack. Ayn clarified that if they wanted to express gratitude, they should thank Yuri, as she was the one who provided treatment. Claudia mentioned that in a few days, she would send a carefully chosen thank you gift. After the usual greetings, Claudia once again attempted to hug Ayn. Yuri, seeing this, quickly intervened, stating that it was not possible because she was Ayn's fiancé. Claudia calmly replied that it was fine, she could become the second wife, as it was not unusual for a man in this era to have multiple wives. Yuri, shocked, loudly exclaimed that Claudia was being too forward. Never in a million years would she allow Claudia to touch Ayn. Yuri added that if Claudia still wanted to touch Ayn, she should touch Yuri instead. Surprisingly, Claudia happily ran over to hug Yuri. Ignoring Yuri's curses, Ursula was extremely happy that her daughter had made a new friend. Ayn really couldn't keep up with these changes but guessed it would be alright since everyone seemed happy. Jasper, sitting next to Ayn, finally spoke up, asking if it was alright to discuss something with Ayn right then. Jasper moved closer to Ayn and stated his intention to marry him. Ayn, upon hearing this, spat out all the tea in his mouth. Claudia, equally surprised, asked Jasper if he intended to become the third wife. But then, who would be the groom in this case? Ayn stated that was not the issue, the problem was that Jasper was a man, and he was not interested in men. Ayn reaffirmed that two men could not marry each other. Claudia burst out laughing, mentioning that in their country, love was not restricted or limited. Yuri, standing aside, was clueless about what was happening, realizing that her current rival was not only female but also male. Jasper interrupted everyone, stating that he first wanted to introduce himself. He was the owner of a guild, neither big nor small, called the Silver Phoenix Corporation. Ayn was astonished, as their products were everywhere, wondering how it could not be well known. Jasper said that he wasn't interested in money, and he would explain why. He led everyone down to a cellar full of glittering jewelry. He loved this collection of jewels from the bottom of his heart and wanted to protect them. He had sworn an oath to keep them shining for centuries. Ayn understood, but this didn't seem relevant to Jasper's desire to marry him. Jasper looked directly into Ayn's eyes and asked if Ayn's left eye was a saint's soul core, wasn't it? The crystallization of Yggdrasil's energy source. He didn't know why it was in Ayn's eye, but that wasn't important. What mattered to Jasper was to have those eyes gaze upon his precious jewels. Jasper said he had always been searching for a saint's soul core, and upon seeing Ayn's eyes, they had stolen his heart. Jasper moved closer to Ayn, asking if Ayn would allow his eyes to reflect Jasper's image. Ayn looked at him, realizing this guy was only interested in that pile of jewels. Ursula stepped in to separate them and pulled Ayn aside, asking what he planned to do. Ayn, worriedly looking at her, of course, said he would refuse, since Jasper was only interested in his eyes after all. Ursula scolded him for being foolish, asking who was talking about that. She suggested that since Jasper had always been searching for soul cores, he must have information about Yggdrasil. Ursula mischievously smiled at Ayn, saying gathering information required money and connections, which he could have by marrying Jasper. Then the chance of finding the hidden dungeon would also be much higher. Ayn thought Ursula was as wicked as a demon, but it was true that searching for a hidden dungeon would take a long time. However, it wouldn't be right to marry someone just to use them. Ayn, feeling awkward, turned back to Jasper. Getting married right now might not be possible, but they could start by being friends. Jasper smiled and said that was fine. From now on, Ayn could stay at this house. He believed by eating and sleeping together, their bond would grow stronger. After all, this house would eventually belong to Ayn anyway. Putting that aside, Ayn asked Jasper if he had any information about other soul cores. Jasper replied that he did, but it was in a rather dangerous place. Everyone who had ventured there for exploration hadn't been able to discover anything, even though they got very close. Ayn asked if Jasper could show him the location. It was very likely he could acquire another soul core. Jasper pondered, another soul core of a saint. Jasper said he understood and would prepare everything carefully for Ayn. 3 days later, the three of them went to the place Jasper had indicated. Yuri happily exclaimed that flying in the sky was truly enjoyable. Thanks to the flying skills learned from the dragon, they moved quickly and soon arrived at the dungeon Jasper had mentioned. Ayn was impressed that even though they were just approaching, the fog was so thick that they couldn't see anything in front of them. It would be better if they could find Yuri's family here. Ursula reminded Ayn that in a minute, a D-class monster named Fog would appear, using smoke bombs to attack. She was curious about how Ayn would plan to attack when they actually appeared. Ayn, seeing the monsters approaching, smiled, saying he had the skill to neutralize attacks. After dealing with them, Ayn walked up to the wall in front. Ursula said the wall seemed to have a teleportation spell. If Ayn touched it, he would surely be teleported somewhere inside the dungeon. As she said, they were teleported to a forest. Ursula could tell that inside, there was a strong magical structure that had altered the dungeon's layout. A voice greeted Yuri, saying it had been a long time. Yuri joyfully called out to her sister, a mischievous little girl. Pina asked if Yuri was going inside with a human. She said she would wait inside, so they must try not to get lost. Ayn, surprised, asked if the girl had been inside all this time while Yuri had traveled a long distance to visit. He requested Pina to teleport them inside. Pina nonchalantly informed him that she couldn't use that magic, so they should proceed on their own. Ayn then remembered that teleportation was a high-level magic, only seen used by Ursula. Pina was extremely proud of the traps and defenses she had set up inside the dungeon. She doubted Ayn could get through them. Ayn, undeterred by her disdain, was determined to clear the dungeon. Knowing the dangers, he asked Yuri to take shelter inside his eye. Pina continued boasting about the tons of traps hidden by illusions and monsters, claiming this was the strongest dungeon she had ever created. Pina said if Ayn begged, she would easily kick him out of the dungeon like a piece of cake. So, giving up early is the best option for you right now. Ayn replied that he understood, but he was confident that it wouldn't be a problem. Pina laughed loudly, asking if he was trying to act cool. She really wanted to see how long he could keep it up. Pina didn't know what Ayn planned to do with Sister Yuri, but she would reveal Ayn's true nature. Pina, observing through her crystal ball, saw Ayn approaching the trap she had set. She thought it was incredibly foolish that he was heading straight for a pitfall without realizing it. Pina was hopeful that this time, she would make Ayn fall flat. However, at that moment, Ursula warned Ayn about the trap. Pina couldn't believe her eyes when she saw Ayn easily avoiding the trap. How was that possible? She had created it with the most perfect illusion magic. Ayn, not annoyed with Pina, explained that he had a very powerful eye. Moreover, having a guide here meant that knowing the enemy's location was normal. Pina was furious about this unfair ability. Ayn, confused, asked what was unfair since he was only using his abilities. Ursula couldn't stand it any longer and told Ayn to focus on clearing the dungeon from now on. She added that if it would bring her daughter back to her sister sooner, she would do anything. As they moved on, Ursula again warned Ayn about a man-eating tree disguised as a normal tree on his left. Thanks to Ursula's continuous warnings, Ayn easily avoided all the traps. Pina was infuriated, flailing her arms and legs. She screamed that she had racked her brain to create this giant maze, and now it was all for nothing. Both Ayn and Ursula radiated indifference. What they cared about was Yuri's smile. A few days after Ayn survived and returned, the reputation of Zoid the Betrayer had spread widely. Wherever he went, he heard curses about turning his teammates into bait. Then Zoid met Jolene and worriedly ran up to her, asking where she had been these past days, making him very anxious. Jolene looked at him with a strange look, asking him not to act so familiar with her, saying she hated it. She accused Zoid of being such a person, using his teammates as bait. Zoid was baffled for a moment, then shouted that it was she who had cast the spell. At that time, she thought her life was very important and wanted to run away. Zoid angrily said that both of them were the same. Jolene suddenly burst into tears, attracting the attention of those around. When people gathered around, she said that she didn't want to do it, but Zoid had forced her. Zoid was genuinely frightened by the girl in front of him. Clearly, these were lies. A person from the crowd stepped forward, stopping Zoid's explanations. He asked why anyone should believe the words of someone who used his teammates as bait. During this time, Zoid was extremely miserable. Wherever he went, he faced hatred and scorn. He thought anyone in his situation would do the same, so why was he the only one bearing all the consequences? But even with the contempt, Zoid still had work to do. He went to find a team far from his area. Unexpectedly, as soon as he met the team, they recognized him and began cursing him as the scoundrel who used his teammates as bait. Finally, they said they didn't need someone like Zoid on their team. Zoid couldn't believe his reputation had spread so far, now, he could only go solo. He needed to complete a high-level mission, the only way to regain trust. The dungeon Zoid was tasked with this time was Pina's dungeon. True to form, as soon as he entered, he fell into a trap and was thrown outside by the girl. Pina enthusiastically told him that he couldn't die inside the dungeon, so he could keep challenging it another time. Not being able to die inside the dungeon was exactly what Zoid needed. He thought if that was the case, he could freely challenge the dungeon as much as possible. And since he didn't have to die, there was nothing to fear. Even if it took tens or hundreds of attempts, he would keep going until he completed it. The second time, Zoid's opponent was an enormous and powerful crocodile. Constantly attacked by it, Zoid, lying on the ground, cursed, realizing it was too strong. Pina's voice echoed again, saying if he wanted to leave, he just had to say, "I give up." Zoid started cursing again, adamant that he had to succeed. In a moment of carelessness, Zoid was overpowered by the monster. He thought to himself that he, with a rare profession, couldn't defeat a monster, maybe he really had to die. Just then, Ayn arrived just in time, quickly rescuing Zoid. Zoid couldn't believe his eyes as he stared at Ayn, who, despite having a seemingly insignificant profession, had taken down the monster with a single blow. Ayn asked why he was there, but Zoid didn't answer, so Ayn declared he was giving up to help him. An hour after meeting Zoid, Ayn reached the final door of the dungeon. They were stopped outside a massive door, they needed to overcome it to meet Ayn. Ayn asked the girl why there was a door leading to the boss's room. Pina cheerfully told Ayn that he needed to defeat the boss to meet the princess, as that was the rule of the game. Ayn still remembered that defeating the boss meant the door to the world tree could not be opened. Ursula clarified this point, saying that as long as the core of the dungeon wasn't destroyed, it would be fine. Ayn didn't fully understand, but what he needed to do now was to defeat the boss. He asked Yuri to wait a bit longer. After opening the door, they found another forest, but Ayn saw no enemy. Soon after, Ursula informed him that the enemy was the ground itself. Ayn quickly flew off the ground, startled at the sight of the giant monster. Ursula identified it as an S-class soul turtle, a creature as big as a mountain. The vegetation growing on its back made it look like a forest. She reminded the young one that there was no time to complain, whoever attacked first would eat. Both were surprised that all their attacks left not a single scratch on it. Ursula felt it was familiar, sensing a magical flow. Ayn, observing closely, noticed something unusual. Despite its huge size, it didn't damage a single tree. Ayn whispered that if it was just defense, he couldn't win, deciding it was all or nothing. Ursula, seeing Ayn walk up to the huge turtle, asked if he wanted to be squashed. Ayn looked at the turtle and said it could hit him with magic but not physically. Its body seemed like an illusion, making it appear bigger than it was. Ayn triumphantly picked up a tiny turtle and told Ursula he was right. A simple illusion had been used as a spell to make the turtle's body appear larger. Ursula commented that such a magical area could only be created by a sorcerer with immense magical power. That was also why she didn't expect a guardian to have such great strength. Ursula said that just this once, she would acknowledge Ayn's achievement. Ayn teased her, asking if she could repeat it louder since he hadn't heard clearly. Ursula, infuriated, shouted that she would never accept someone like him as Yuri's husband. Eventually, Pina also conceded to Ayn. After a joyful reunion between Yuri and her sister, Pina asked if she could join them, saying she was tired of being underground and managing the game. She also promised to give Ayn a soul core like Yuri's. Ayn asked Ursula if it was okay to receive another artificial eye. Ursula had no objections. Pina hugged her sister, expressing her happiness to be beside Yuri. Ursula interrupted their emotional moment, saying that while she adds Pina's soul core to Ayn's eye, he should go and explain to Pina's guardian. She reminded him to make sure not to show any disrespect. It was then that Ayn remembered the need for a guardian like Ursula. The turtle on Ayn's shoulder began to laugh and greeted Ayn before transforming into a little girl, apologizing for surprising him. She introduced herself as Pina's guardian, Kuroheim, daughter of the primitive beast Genbu. Ayn was astonished that the turtle was actually a guardian but in the form of a child. Kuroheim laughed, saying Ayn's surprised face was cute. She explained that even though she looked like a child, she was older than him. Being a child of one of the primitive beasts, Genbu, her true age was significantly different. Ayn said he wanted to discuss with Pina's guardian about taking her outside. Kuroheim happily agreed, saying she always wanted the child to see the outside world. But she asked if it was okay to take her along too. Ayn wondered who would protect the tree then. Kuroheim presented a gem, assuring him not to worry about that, he should treat her as the gem and never lose it. Ayn recognized it as a sage stone, similar to what Ursula had added to his artificial eye. Kuroheim explained that her consciousness would be connected through space, and her ability was to create barriers, capable of withstanding both magical and physical attacks. A few days after the incident, Ayn accompanied Jasper to his guild. Jasper explained that there was a rule prohibiting the trade or purchase of any magical items or artifacts outside the guild. He reassured Ayn that there would be no issues with him there. Wherever Jasper went, he received a multitude of compliments, but he ignored the gazes of the crowd and led Ayn inside the guild. Ayn told the receptionist he wanted to sell magical items and buy everything Jasper was selling. Only then did people start noticing Ayn, questioning who he was and why he looked so frail. The girl at the reception, upon seeing Ayn's guild card, exclaimed in shock that he was just an appraiser. She skeptically asked Jasper if Ayn had anything they could actually buy. The surrounding people started laughing, thinking that Jewel King had been fooled. Yuri, inside Ayn, was angered by their rude comments, despite them knowing nothing about Ayn. Jasper, ignoring the crowd, urged Ayn to bring out what he wanted to sell. Everyone was taken aback by the array of items Ayn produced. The girl next to him, wide-eyed, asked where he got so many rare items. The head of the Adventurer's Guild in the capital, Maigan, came out and reprimanded the others for their ignorance, saying one should not judge a person by their appearance. She apologized on their behalf. Everyone was unsure what Maigan's sudden appearance there meant. Ayn had heard rumors that the Royal Capital's Adventurer's Guild was where the strongest members gathered, and Maigan, the guild head, was the one who had united them. Ayn disliked the other members who had mocked him, but the person standing before him was different from the rest. The girl next to him, with a shaky voice, announced that after using the True Eye magical item for appraisal, all the items were genuine. She loudly repeated that there was no mistake, everything was real. Jasper looked around at the crowd and asked if they understood now. If Ayn were a thief as they had thought, could he have obtained all these items? He reaffirmed that Ayn was strong and had defeated monsters using his own strength, putting his honor on the line to assert this. A few people agreed that anyone accompanying Jasper couldn't be ordinary. The girl who had been skeptical earlier approached Ayn, bowing and apologizing. Maigan walked over, laughing, and asked if the girl had heard her own words about not judging others by their appearance. Maigan continued, saying that there are people whose fate seem predetermined from birth, but she finds those who can escape such fates truly interesting. The girl, anxiously, loudly addressed Ayn as, "Sir," accepting any punishment and pleading for forgiveness. Ayn laughed heartily, saying that knowing there were people like Maigan in the guild made him very happy. Maigan, impressed, leaned in and grabbed Ayn's collar, commending his response. She expressed her particular liking for strong individuals like Ayn and proposed that he join the Royal Adventurers Guild. Yuri, inside Ayn, was uncomfortable with how close Maigan was getting to her Ayn. Just then, Maigan released Ayn, laughing loudly and suggesting that he take some time to think about it. She felt they would meet again in the future. The previously skeptical girl whispered to Ayn and Jasper that they could now go to the VIP room to collect the money. Jasper suggested that Ayn wait a moment and bring out the rest of the items. The crowd was astounded, asking if there was more. Ayn honestly said that what he brought was just a small part, and there were still many monster corpses in the hidden dungeon. People were shocked, asking if he had cleared the hidden dungeon. Some, excitedly, loudly asked who he really was and crowded around, eager to hear how he defeated the Immortal King. The room turned into a marketplace with people apologizing for having underestimated Ayn. Others chased after him, seeking to learn from his experience. Ayn tried to escape the crowd, yelling for them to give him a moment to think. An old man leading the group asked why he was running away and pleaded for Ayn to share his stories with them. After a morning of full rest, Ayn felt something eventful might happen that day. As he went downstairs, he received a message from Jasper that the guildmaster wanted to see him. Ayn asked why it had to be him, and Maigen calmly said it was because he could defeat a strong opponent. She asked if he had heard of Behemoth. When the demon lord Mictlan was still rampant, it was one of the dragons born to serve him. After Mictlan was sealed, those dragons also disappeared. Somehow, those dragons had reappeared and were now targeting the wealth of traders and even attacking humans. Maigen had personally come to ask for Ayn's help. She explained that they really needed his assistance to defeat the Behemoth, an SS-rank dragon. Ayn was surprised, asking if SS-rank wasn't beyond the highest rank, S. Maigen clarified that S-rank was the limit for ordinary monsters, but there were levels of strength in this world that they couldn't measure. Ayn realized how vast this world was, implying there were even stronger beings than those he had encountered in the dungeons. Jasper then spoke up, knowing Ayn didn't want to get involved with the guild. Ayn responded that he accepted, meaning the dragon was causing trouble for people, right? Jasper didn't reply, just smiled, which puzzled Ayn. Jasper moved closer to Ayn, admitting he was a bit emotional. An SS-rank mission was something that could cost one's life, but Ayn had accepted immediately to help people he didn't even know. This was something ordinary people wouldn't do. Jasper expressed his pride in Ayn, believing his strength matched his heart. Bacchus, the captain of the first team of the Adventurers Guild, appeared, urging Maigen to wait. He loudly proclaimed that instead of relying on a frail person like Ayn, he, the strongest in the royal capital, could easily defeat Behemoth. Maigen asked him to leave, saying she couldn't accept this. Bacchus refused to believe the request was for someone of a normal profession, insisting a regular profession could never outdo a dual swordsman. Maigen warned him to stop or she would expel him from the guild. Bacchus approached Ayn, challenging him to a fight, saying if he won, he would earn the honor of defeating Behemoth. Ayn replied that if Bacchus wanted to fight the dragon that badly, he could. Bacchus loudly declared he knew Ayn's dungeon clearing story was fake and that Ayn was just afraid to fight him due to his low power. Ayn, genuinely angry, replied that it was what Bacchus thought. He didn't see it as a good enough reason to fight. Bacchus attacked first, but Ayn intended to knock him out without using full strength, yet Bacchus ended up crashing into a wall. Bacchus was surprised he had been defeated. Ayn sighed in relief, thanking God that Bacchus was still alive. Maigen approached, apologizing on Bacchus's behalf. She explained that he was a good person but had gotten caught up in the pursuit of fame and glory. The tale of the ancient, immensely boring dragon, never acquainted with defeat, unfolds. This ancient dragon, crafted by the Demon King, had never met an adversary stronger than itself. Born with overwhelming power, it lived in a dull and peaceful world where no one could pose a threat to it. The dragon often wondered if there was a warrior strong enough to challenge it. Yet, it would always dismiss the thought, only to be met with disappointment from its unfulfilled expectations. To the dragon, humans were too feeble, merely serving as food. However, there were places where people rose to oppose it, a sight so pitifully tragic. In one such moment, the villagers, fearfully pointing their swords, cried out, "There it is, the Demon King's Behemoth Dragon." The men of the village stood in defense of their beloved homes and families, ready to embrace death to protect their loved ones. Hearing this, Behemoth effortlessly erased the village from existence, mockingly asking where their village had gone. As the villagers lunged to attack, they were all knocked to the ground. Confused, they questioned what just happened, overwhelmed by the immense magical power. The dragon stated that what they witnessed was merely its breath, not even its true magic. The people were plunged into despair, realizing they had no chance of victory. Just then, Ayn appeared, standing right in front of Behemoth. The curious dragon thought that surely this prey wouldn't just walk into its mouth. Ayn, seemingly weak yet capable of magic, was dismissed by the dragon, declaring magic useless against it. Ayn retorted that it had caused enough trouble for the people, and he was there to defeat it. Behemoth laughed loudly, intrigued by how such a frail being thought it could defeat anyone. The dragon admired Ayn's courage but reminded him that it was created by the Demon King with overwhelming power. Ayn laughed heartily, remarking that the so-called Demon King was just second-rate. Enraged at this insult to the demon king, Behemoth unleashed a tempestuous attack on Ayame. To its surprise, it demanded to know why a bullet that tore through space failed to hit Ayame. Ayame taunted the dragon about its possibly failing eyesight. Furious, Behemoth vowed to silence Ayame's insolence. Ayame chuckled, confident that no matter how many attacks were launched, they would never hit. Before the attack, Ayame swiftly sliced off a piece of the dragon's skin. Behemoth screamed in disbelief, its skin as hard as orichalcum, yet Ayame could cut through it. Ayame replied that if that was the case, its defenses were quite weak. The dragon roared in frustration, questioning why it couldn't hit Ayame, and then suddenly vanished. Behemoth re-emerged from the ground behind Ayame, thinking that no matter how fast Ayame was, if he couldn't predict the next attack, he couldn't dodge it. Behemoth shouted that its return to the ground marked Ayame's end. After biting the ground where Ayame stood, it laughed triumphantly, believing it had consumed Ayame. Had you not raised a claw against me, perhaps you could have lived longer, it thought. But the situation was not as simple as it seemed. Ayame suddenly reappeared, delivering a fatal slash to the dragon. In that moment, Behemoth realized Ayame's eyes were not those of a human, but of a predator. Behemoth couldn't believe it was being vanquished. Ayame explained he had cast a spell inside the dragon's body. The dragon could absorb magic through its skin, but had no internal defenses. Moreover, before being eaten by it, Ayame had set up a barrier. From the moment Behemoth went underground to its demise, it was trapped in Ayame's illusion. Even Ayame's provocation was part of the plan. Ayame pointed out that the dragon's downfall was due to its arrogance. Behemoth admitted defeat, acknowledging it had lost to Ayame from the start. Ursula, observing Ayame's thoughtful expression, asked how he was. Ayame pondered whether Behemoth was inherently evil or merely influenced by the Demon King. Ursula consoled him, saying even if he pondered its nature for a lifetime, the manner of its birth was irrelevant. The dragon would continue to attack humans without change until it eventually died. Ursula then mentioned copying the dragon's skills, noting the ancient dragon possessed many abilities. Upon completing the mission and returning home, Ayame collapsed into a chair, exhausted. Behemoth was indeed a different caliber, far superior to other boss monsters. Outside, Claudia entered, ceaselessly praising Ayame as a hero. Yuri appeared, intervening and declaring her claim over Ayame as her husband. Ayame loudly called out Yuri's name, feeling an increased pressure in his right eye when she spoke like that. Claudia, unbothered by the two, informed Ayame that her father wished to meet him. Ayame was surprised to see the king standing in his room, uncertain of how to properly greet him. The king told Ayame to relax, as he came not in his capacity as a king, but as Claudia's father. Sitting down, he looked at Ayame and marveled at him being the dragon slayer. The king observed that Ayame possessed not only tremendous strength but also an allure to women. He expressed pride in his daughter's husband being such a renowned figure. Ayame, taken aback, loudly questioned what the king had just said, feeling it was a bit too far. The king laughed, pleased to see Ayame finally relax. He apologized for the sudden visit, wanting to meet Ayame without formalities. He announced that a ceremony would be held in Ayame's honor to show gratitude for his help in slaying the dragon. Ayame humbly stated he only did what he could. Claudia looked at Ayame, admiring his strength and modesty. The king then shifted the conversation to his daughter, who constantly talked about Ayame. He told Ayame not to worry about resolving his daughter's issues. Since Ayame had once saved Claudia, the king felt he owed him a proper thanks. He presented a watch and the royal seal, which would allow Ayame to travel freely. Ayame accepted, knowing this would ease his explorations in unreachable places. The next morning, Yuri woke up to find Pina casually entering from outside. She asked her younger sister if she had just finished bathing and if it was still comfortable to move around without being near Ayame. Pina replied that normally they couldn't go far from Ayame, but Ursula mentioned that the area they could move around was quite large. Speaking of Ayame, Yuri worriedly wondered if something had happened to him since he had been sleeping non-stop since their return. Pina reassured her, saying she heard from their mother that he was just overly tired. She suggested they cook something to cheer him up. Excitedly, Pina ran towards the door, saying if they had decided, then it was time to go shopping, as it had been a long time since they last went out together. Yuri hesitated, worried about potential dangers outside. Pina confidently assured her sister that they would be fine and wouldn't run into any trouble. Meanwhile, Ayn, in his deep sleep, dreamt of the past times when he was oppressed by Zoid. Zoid berated Ayn, telling him to be grateful for receiving money for a worthless nobody. He also scorned Ayn's weakest profession, suggesting that no matter how hard he tried, he couldn't live well. Ayn dreamt of a time when he was cornered by a pack of dogs. He realized this world was full of opportunities and that if he hadn't met Yuri, he might have died long ago. In his dream, a hideous face, bitten by a dog, told Ayn it was just luck. That face cursed Ayn as garbage, claiming his nature as the weakest hadn't changed. Ayn woke up startled, with Ursula standing beside him, asking if he was okay. She scolded him for overexerting himself and sleeping continuously, calling him too greedy. Ayn apologized to her for causing trouble. Ursula softened but claimed she was only worried about Yuri and the others. Upon hearing Yuri's name, Ayn asked about her whereabouts. Ursula informed him that the sisters had gone to town and that she knew Yuri's location and would rush there if anything happened. Ursula then asked if Ayn had rested enough and seemed to have had a nightmare. Ayn admitted to having a terrible dream, saying his fate only changed because he met Yuri and the others. Without this change, he might have ended up in a wolf's belly or hell. Ayn felt his character hadn't changed, he was still worthless. Meanwhile, Zoid, now reduced to a beggar, was approached by a spirit offering to help him take revenge. The spirit informed Zoid about the soul Ayn possessed, which made him stronger without effort. This revelation angered Zoid further, understanding why that worthless person had become stronger. The spirit helped Zoid by implanting a soul eye into him, turning his body into a monster. Zoid felt incredibly light, having shed his weak human form. His first target for revenge was Jolene. After devouring her, he felt great. The spirit reminded Zoid not to forget his main target, Ayn. Pina joyfully ran through the streets, urging her sister Yuri to hurry. Unbeknownst to them, Zoid, now a monster, was gradually approaching their location. Yuri, lacking the same energy as her sister, trailed behind, calling out for Pina to wait for her. Pina stopped, reminding her they wanted to prepare a nutritious meal for Ayn. Yuri agreed, saying she must try her hardest, just as Ayn always does to protect them. Being protected by Ayn made her happy, but she didn't want to be just a beneficiary, she wanted to give back too. As they were chatting cheerfully, a loud noise erupted from a building across the street. People began to run in panic, screaming about a monster. A child hit by the chaos cried out in pain. Yuri rushed over to check on the boy, assuring him that she would heal his wounds. The large cut on the boy's arm healed quickly. Yuri asked if he could run to find shelter by himself. The boy looked at her worriedly, asking what about her. Yuri smiled, saying she would be fine and would run after healing others. Meanwhile, Zoid was preparing to attack a person who had fallen in his way, mistaking them for an obstacle. Yuri quickly helped and healed the person. A demon, observing from atop a nearby building, informed Zoid that the child was actually a soul. Conveniently, she was the very soul that had given Ayn the power of the eye. Zoid laughed loudly, realizing that killing Yuri would immediately reduce Ayn to nothing. Pina, sensing the danger, rushed over and used Kuro's barrier ability to protect her sister. Yuri, worried, called out to her sister but hesitated to run away. The demon informed Zoid that it was just another soul ability. He could attack recklessly without breaking the soul's power. The demon laughed, explaining that the power she granted Zoid was to counter soul abilities. Zoid easily broke the barrier following the demon's guidance. She laughed, saying that now he could counter any soul skill when confronted, and urged him to pursue them. Yuri and Pina were driven into a dead-end alley with no escape. Pina tried to use the barrier again, but it was ineffective this time. Yuri stepped forward to protect her sister, confident that Ayn and their mother would come. Zoid, grabbing Yuri, taunted her for being foolish enough to give her power to a worthless person like Ayn. Luckily, Ayn arrived just in time to protect Yuri. Concerned, he asked if the two were all right. Ursula apologized for being late despite knowing their location. Seeing Yuri terrified, Ayn felt a deep ache in his heart, knowing she must have been scared yet still stood up to protect her sister. Ayn tried to assess the monster's identity but couldn't discern it, leading Ursula to suggest that it might be using a skill to hide itself. Despite several attempts, Ayn failed, and the monster mockingly asked if that was all he could do, calling him a mere scavenger. Recognizing the voice, Ayn turned to the monster and asked, "Is that you, Zoid?" Laughing loudly, Zoid declared they were no longer on the same level, having evolved thanks to the divine protection of a soul. Ayn wondered if this protection was similar to his own. Ursula reminded Ayn to focus as an attack was coming. She scolded him for dodging, warning that he would be in trouble if he didn't fight back. Zoid boasted about his immense power, claiming Ayn could have had the same strength but instead chose to be an oddity. Zoid questioned why Ayn didn't use his power for personal gain, laughing that realizing the extent of his power made other desires seem trivial. Zoid continued, saying Ayn, being similar to him, would understand. He accused Ayn of wearing a mask of goodness, driven by a desire for revenge against those who had wronged him. Yuri stepped beside Ayn, asserting he was not that kind of person, confidently stating that Ayn was truly kind-hearted. Zoid mocked her, questioning how she could understand Ayn's nature before she had empowered him. He dredged up Ayn's past, stating that Ayn had done many things to survive without self-respect. Zoid insisted that despite gaining some strength, Ayn hadn't really changed. Ursula stepped forward, urging Ayn to listen to her, affirming he had grown stronger not just physically, but his heart had matured as well. She had observed every step of his growth, even aware of Zoid using Ayn's weaknesses against him. Ursula emphatically reminded Ayn of the numerous lives he had saved, questioning whether he had ever oppressed anyone since gaining his power. "Isn't it true that you once said repaying Yuri is the most important thing? Ursula knows that the courage and kindness in you wasn't given by Yuri. It was already inside you from the beginning, and you've been honing your strength every day." Yuri steps forward to say that although Ayn told her it was thanks to everyone that he became stronger, for her, Ayn is the benefactor who helped her find her family. Yuri affirms that her fate changed because of Ayn. Ayn cries out, unsure if he really has become stronger. He has always hated this world, ruled by professions, especially because he couldn't change his own. With a weak profession, Ayn felt feeble. He got stronger with Yuri and others, but that made him deny his true self. He only knew how to run and be selfish, but Yuri and everyone believed in him. Therefore, he needs to repay everyone. Ayn must become someone they can rely on. Ayn won't hesitate anymore, he will become strong to protect everyone. To repay their trust, Ayn has become the strongest guardian. Ursula approaches, saying Ayn has now perfectly awakened the power of the guardian. He can finally use 100% of the soul's power. She asks if he never found it strange that despite possessing a soul that can generate infinite energy, his mana never changed. Ayn, puzzled, asks if that's really true. Ursula, touching her forehead, says Ayn never realized he had become the soul's guardian. In fact, he even denied it, which is why he couldn't use Yuri's power. Zoid, going mad, screams that he also has power within him and then attacks Ayn. But Ayn easily catches his movement. Ursula, proudly, states that Ayn can now use 100% of the soul's power, while Zoid only about 10%. Zoid yells for the soul to give him more power. Ayn channels his anger and sorrow into a final attack on Zoid. Zoid reverts to human form, kneeling on the ground, asking why Ayn would save him. Even after he tried to kill you time and again. Ayn extends his hand towards Zoid, offering to help him up. Ayn questions, "Can't I save others just because I'm weak? Or should I only be a servant if I'm weak?" Ayn tells him that from now on, he will no longer run away. He laughs and asks, "If even I can change, why can't you?" The first step for Zoid is just to take the offered hand, that alone would be enough. Zoid, finally shedding tears, grabs Ayn's hand and stands up. Soldiers arrive to take Zoid away for attacking the royal capital. Ayn knows Zoid is scum but believes he couldn't have gone far alone. He's sure someone exploited Zoid's weak heart and endowed him with the soul's power. That night, amidst the ruins of the damaged area, the demon giving Zoid power finally appears. She's pleased that the data collection on Ayn's combat abilities is complete. The plan went exceedingly well. Not only that, but the damage was minimized because Ayn arrived in time. She also saw her annoying little sister running around healing the injured. To her surprise, Zoid didn't die in the battle. Ayn had combined Yuri's healing ability into his final sword strike, complicating things. Her expression changes as she calls out to Mictlan, vowing to resurrect him. Her main goal is to bring back the demon lord. She disappears into the night with a sinister smile. The battle ends, and Ayn returns to his daily life. Yuri, shyly approaching Ayn, asks if he could kiss her. Surprised, Ayn replies that she shouldn't joke about that. Yuri insists she's serious, stating it's a soul contract between a soul and its guardian. Ursula explains, reluctantly, that although she doesn't want this, it's necessary. Until now, Ayn was somewhat an apprentice guardian, and the bond between him and Yuri wasn't normal. That's why the magic power he receives from Yuri sometimes fluctuates. To prevent Ayn from being overloaded with magic power, Yuri has been bearing this burden. Now that Ayn has awakened as a guardian, he has established a bond with Yuri. This necessitates strengthening their connection, hence the emergence of this contract. After hearing Ursula's explanation, Ayn apologizes to Yuri, unaware of the burden she's been carrying. In the Demon Kingdom, also known as the Underworld, the demon girl returns and asks Falcon if he's okay. A beast-like demon asks her in return how she is doing, welcoming her to the mansion. He points to a cage containing children, saying he's just received some humans but they're fine, and asks if she'd like to join him for dinner. Echidona says maybe another time, today she's here to deliver the Emperor's orders to him. Falco, reading the directive, asks if it's a joke from the demon uncle, ordering him to kill a mere runt. Echidona replies that the boy might look insignificant, but he is the one who killed the dragon behemoth. She advises Falco not to be overconfident, she likes strong people. That's also why the demon lord and she rely on Falco for such an important task. Falco laughs, saying if that's the case, he'll easily accomplish it. He flies at an incredibly fast speed to Ayn's location, proud of his ability Wind Thrust, which allows him to fly extremely fast in a straight line. Knowing the time gate to the underworld has limits, Falco aims to complete his mission quickly. Standing before Ayn, Falco declares he's there to take Ayn's life, offering him the choice to die happily or resist and die. Ayn, still sleepy, asks why Falco has come at this hour to kill him and requests him to be quieter as everyone is still asleep. Falco scolds Ayn for being so audacious despite being as weak as a monkey and having luckily killed the dragon. Falco yells that Ayn's end is sure. Before Ayn gets hurt, Falco is already hit by his own counterattack, unable to see anything. Falco can't continue moving, as if bound by chains. After easily defeating Falco, Ayn moves forward to copy his skills. The noise wakes everyone up. Ursula praises Ayn, affirming that he has indeed become a true guardian. Ayn, along with Yuri's group, arrives at the royal palace. A majestic castle unfolds before them, leaving Ayn looking up in awe. Two guards at the door ask him what he's doing. Innocently, Ayn states he wants to enter the castle. The guards laugh loudly, saying it's not a place for commoners, and ask about his profession. Ayn simply replies that he is an appraiser. The guards mock him, saying a lowly scavenger like him thinks he can enter the royal palace. Another guard tells him to leave and go back to scavenging. Ayn shows them the king's silver watch and asks if this would allow him entry. The guards are stunned and question how someone with a lowly profession could possess such an item. They start observing the young man with black hair and unique eyes. This is the person who saved the city in the capital the other day and, above all, defeated Behemoth. They apologize for their rudeness and then invite him inside. Ayn sighs in relief, he had just stepped into the palace and already encountered trouble, but luckily, he had the king's watch with him. Claudia rushes out to greet the hero, saying it's rare for a hero to visit her. Ayn bluntly states he's there to use the Forbidden Library, not to visit her. The Forbidden Library, filled with numerous books, is accessible only to the royal family. Ayn thinks to himself that with the king's watch, he can now access places he has never been to before. With the library's support, he hopes to find more clues related to the hidden dungeon linked to Yuri's family. Claudia informs Ayn that according to the contract, he can only enter with the king's permission and the librarian's consent. She regrets only being able to guide him thus far. Ayn smiles and says it's okay, as he already has the king's permission. Claudia explains that for the librarian's consent, he just needs to open the library door and step in. Ayn easily opens the door and steps in. Yuri and Ursula are then stopped by an invisible wall outside. At that moment, Ayn also loses his connection with everyone. Ursula, more puzzled than the other two, asks if she can't teleport there. She's tried many times, but it seems a powerful skill has been deployed to repel anyone who isn't human. Ayn understands that he can only enter the library alone, and he assures Yuri and the others not to worry. Inside, Ayn is surprised by the sheer number of books, so many that the ceiling is not visible. Suddenly, he catches a falling girl, who seems to have ears similar to Yuri's sister's. After talking for a bit, Ayn realizes this girl is the librarian and thanks her for allowing him entry. Alice asks why he has come. Ayn explains he's there to investigate a hidden dungeon to help a friend find her family. Without hesitation, Alice hands him a book. As Ayn joyfully turns to leave, Alice suddenly asks if Yuri is okay, saying she can see Yuri's core within Ayn's eyes. Ayn asks if Alice is the soul of the Yggdrasil tree. Alice's guardian, bringing tea and cakes, reprimands her for not informing her about the guest. Ayn, recognizing the pattern, identifies her as the guardian. Akahahe introduces herself as the guardian and daughter of the legendary Suzaku. She thanks Ayn for getting along with her daughter, saying she has never seen her so happy. Alice coldly looks at them, wondering where the fun is. Akahahe offers cookies to her daughter, but Alice bluntly refuses. Akahahe laughs, saying her response is cold, but she doesn't want Ayn to misunderstand. Alice is likely just nervous in front of someone so cool. Ayn points out to Alice that she's reading a book upside down. Akahahe laughs even harder, saying her daughter is extremely cute. Alice magically stuffs a plate of cookies into Akahahe's mouth, telling her to be quiet. Ayn is astonished by this rude behavior, considering she is her mother. Setting that aside, Ayn tells her that Yuri and Pina are waiting outside, and they should go meet them. Akahahe asks if Ayn passed through a gate before arriving. It's a device that transports people to a different location. Actually, they aren't in the castle but in a completely different place in a hidden dungeon. The dungeon is connected to the castle through the gate. One special feature of the gate is that only humans can pass through it. There's also a power limit, only those permitted by the king and Alice are allowed entry. This rule has been in place since the time of Mictlan, decided jointly by him, the king, and a previous generation ruler. All the secrets of this country are here. To uphold the agreement to protect this place under the power of a Yggdrasil soul, they use the books here as part of the contract, ensuring their safety. Ayn asks Akahahe if he can take Alice outside. She says it seems difficult as her daughter is like a closed-off seed, lacking physical strength. Ayn says he really wants to meet them, but she seems scared. He knows the outside world is terrifying, but he's overcome it thanks to Yuri and her group. Ayn promises to help Alice with all his strength and defeat all monsters, ensuring her safe return to Yuri and the others. He sincerely asks if she can trust and come with him. Akahahe laughs, looking at her daughter blushing profusely. Ayn smiles, realizing maybe his request was too abrupt, and says he'll come back another time. He immediately shares this good news with Yuri upon returning. The next day, Ayn continues to search for information in the library. Surprisingly, this time Alice wants to go outside with everyone. Akahahe gives Ayn Alice's soul core because without it, she can't leave. As Akahahe can't use teleportation magic like Ursula, she will send a duplicate to accompany them. The three of them head to the outside world. Ayn enters the hidden dungeon, which is quite different from the others. He knows there won't be any help from Ursula until he exits the dungeon. His left eye has also temporarily disconnected from Yuri and the others. While Ayn is still thinking, Akahahe exclaims there's trouble. Ayn asks if it's a monster, but he won't let his guard down. She simply points to her daughter and informs him that she's tired. Ayn is puzzled since they've barely walked 5 minutes, finding it a hindrance. He apologizes for not noticing and suggests they rest for a while. Akahahe mysteriously smiles and says they are in a hurry and can't stop every 5 minutes. Akahahe asks Ayn what he thinks about carrying Alice on his back, then whispers to Alice that this is her chance, there's nothing to worry about. As Ayn carries Alice forward, Akahahe secretly approves of him. Suddenly, Ayn uses spiral twist 50 times moving forward. Akahahe, astonished, asks why he used it so abruptly. Ayn explains he just defeated a swarm of moths. Akahahe can't believe her eyes, as Ayn defeats enemies without even seeing them. She knew he was strong, but this is beyond expectation. Another fast-moving monster appears, too quick to see. Alice asks if she should get down, but Ayn, while simultaneously dealing with a grasshopper, declines. Akahahe asks what he did, as she only blinked and it was gone. Ayame explains he used magic, and his special eye made from a soul stone allows him to catch such speed immediately. Ayame suggests they've come far enough and should rest. Akahahe regrets not bringing food and assumes Ayame doesn't have any, but she is again amazed when Ayame prepares a full meal, resembling a tea party, using his magic seal with unlimited storage. Akahahe marvels at his abilities. While they are talking, an Iron Knight appears, intent on attacking. Akahahe is afraid of it because of its near-perfect accuracy and near-useless counterattacks. Before she can react, the monster is shattered into pieces. Akahahe, looking at Ayame in disbelief, mutters that her daughter is in love with a monster. They soon reach the boss room. Akahahe notes the boss monster's energy, stating it's different from the others they've faced. Ayame informs her that it's a monster created from the body of a person once known as the Holy Sword, and also the strongest knight of the kingdom. It can slash enemies from a distance with its sword swing skill and uses Ayanuki at high speed when the enemy is in range. Ayame whispers that this one is quite troublesome. Alice steps forward, standing next to Ayame, expressing her trust in him. Ayame, wielding his sword, steps forward and says to leave it to him. The entire room is likely within the monster's range for sword swing and Ayanuki. Ayame uses super appraisal on the monster and realizes his eye can stop an S-rank monster's movement, but not its sword attack. He switches to counter, which can double the strength of a counterattack and stop even faster attacks. However, Ayame realizes he can't break the monster's body, admitting his sword skills are self-taught and amateurish. He compensates with the special ability of his saint's eye. Ayame decides to use his eye to follow the monster's sword path. Knowing he can't compete in swordsmanship alone, Ayame throws his sword away. Akahahe, in shock, asks what he's doing. Immediately after, the monster's sword also falls, and everything happens in a flash until the monster is defeated. Akahahe comments on how quickly it happened, not even realizing what just occurred. She asks if Ayame caused the monster to lose grip on its sword. Ayame explains he attached his sword to sticky thread before throwing it at the enemy's sword, and the elasticity of the thread pulled the monster's sword away. Akahahe is amazed at how quickly he formulated such a perfect plan. Alice runs to Ayame and extends her hands towards him, causing Ayame to look puzzled. Her mother explains that Alice is just worried and checking if Ayame is hurt. Ayame laughs, assuring he's fine and there's no need to worry. When Ayame turns away, Akahahe tells her daughter she's being too imaginative. Ayame approaches the trembling sword. Akahahe mentions a special type of sword known as a holy sword that can choose its own master, loyal to the swordsman for life. Ayame regrets losing a good sword but is happy they are nearing the end of the dungeon. Alice looks unhappy, prompting Akahahe to laugh and say she's upset because Ayame is no longer carrying her. Without much thought, Ayame replies that he can carry her again once they are above ground. Yuri, seeing Alice, runs to hug her joyfully. Ayame looks at their reunion and feels vicariously happy. Alice grabs Ayane's hand, expressing her desire to stay with everyone. Ayame thinks to himself that she finally got to reunite with her family. Pina, hearing this, runs to hug Alice, glad that they can now explore together. Akahahe sits in a corner, smiling secretly, thinking that perhaps her daughter's confession didn't reach Ayame. Kuro comments that love is never a smooth journey. The next day, Ayame is unsure what to do next to find the remaining five people. Maigen comes from behind, hugs him, and mentions he seems taller now. Jasper, following behind, says they have a new request from the guild, directly from the king. He asks Ayame if he knows anything about demons. Ayame replies that he once defeated one at the mansion, with a head like a bird. Jasper is surprised and asks again if a demon had come there. Ayame, embarrassed, explains he created a shield around the mansion, not wanting anyone to be in danger. He had thought not to tell anyone to avoid worry. Jasper acknowledges Ayane's reluctance to bother others, but says it's both his strength and weakness. He encourages Ayame to ask for help when needed. Jasper explains that demons are beings banished from the human world centuries ago. A hero created a spatial barrier to hide them from public view. The truth is, demons haven't been completely defeated, they still appear and attack humans. Only a few are aware of this. Maigen points to the Razik territory on the map, where demons frequently appear. The current task is to eliminate these demons, but unfortunately, ordinary adventurers can't defeat them. And due to recent peace, the number of adventurers is decreasing. Ayame immediately volunteers to help in that territory. Ursula disagrees, questioning why they should help when they have other purposes. Ayame responds that when they first met without any connection, everyone still helped him. He understands the fear and despair of facing an unbeatable enemy, and he owes his survival to being rescued. Therefore, Ayame wants to help others the way Yuri and Ursula helped him before. Moreover, Ayame believes they will uncover the reason why that demon wants to attack him. Yuri is the first to laugh, saying she also thinks the same. She urges the others to quickly go and rescue the victims. Pina, somewhat lazily, replies that it's fine, agreeing with the plan. Yuri runs over and hugs Ursula, laughing and saying if that's what Ayame wants to do, then there's nothing to refuse. The domain of Raisk, a place swarming with demons. A place where people can't survive without sacrifice. Today, little Mia is to become the village's sacrificial offering. Mia, led by her father's hand, tells him she's hungry. With a heavy heart, he looks at his daughter and reassures her that it will be okay, they're going to a place with lots of delicious food. The naive girl continues to ask if that place is like heaven, where her mother is. The father, with a pained expression, promises that soon she will meet her mother. A villager loudly announces for everyone to pay attention as Hydra-sama is about to arrive and they should kneel. The disgusting demon appears, demanding from the villagers where his food is. The innocent Mia asks her father what Hydra-sama is. He explains that it's a serpent god who will protect their village. He strokes his daughter's head, telling her to go as the god will take her to meet Wowie. He says he can't go with her, but he will surely be behind her. Mia looks at her father, agreeing, wanting to bring back delicious food for him. She recalls her father being very tearful when her mother went to heaven, but it won't be the same for her. Mia adds that it's because she won't be there to cry for him anymore. The father, panic-stricken, grabs her hand, asking if she already knows. Mia runs to the side of the monster, pleading with Hydra-sama to take her to heaven. Mia's father runs to embrace her, saying he can't do it. The villagers scold him, saying Mia is naturally weak and won't live long. It's for both Mia and the village, they had already discussed and agreed. The father prostrates on the ground, begging the monster to eat him instead of his daughter. Ayame arrives just in time, using a shield to protect Mia from the monster's grotesque mouth. He asks if she's okay, it's very dangerous so she should hide behind him. With his clairvoyant eye, he saw the attack on the people and used his fastest strength to get there. Ursula informs him that this monster is an ancient SS-class dragon. It has the ability to create both medicine and poison. Its outer skin is always covered in a deadly toxin. Ayame asks Yuri for help, then looks at the villagers who were poisoned. To their surprise, the poison disappears and their wounds heal rapidly. The dragon is baffled by the absurdity, how can someone neutralize poison just with a glance? Ayame thinks to himself about the growing power of his holy eye. Yuri's healing powers have naturally strengthened as well, and the sensation is incredible. Ayame tells Mia's father to take her away, as he will fight this monster. The villagers start to gossip, viewing Ayame as some sort of adventurer, but they believe no one can defeat him. While everyone debates whether to flee, Ayame manages to take down the dragon. The villagers are so astonished that they could almost drop their eyes out. Ursula, for once, compliments Ayame for doing a great job. The villagers line up to thank Ayame. He bids them farewell as they have more important things to do, like finding the lord of this region. Nigen brings out sweets and tea to entertain Ayame, commenting that it seems he had a long and tiring journey to get here. Akahahe is angry that while people in the village are nearly starving, this guy has so much food that he can afford desserts. Ayame speaks up, wanting to start by knowing about the demons in the village. He asks for general information like where they usually appear and who the victims are. Nigen asks if he means demons. They were defeated by a hero long ago. She asserts that she has never seen such things in Rasik village. There are many monsters in the mysterious deep forest, and maybe the story comes from rumors around there. Ayame is surprised and asks her again if there really are no demons. Yuri suggests that maybe she is trying to deceive him. Ayame asks again, then what about the report that there are demons here? Regardless of whether there are demons or not, he has seen the villagers living in extreme hardship. Ayame tells Nigen if there is truly something he can do, please let him know. Because he is here now, has defeated Hydra, and he has received food. Nigen suddenly stands up, loudly asking if he really defeated Hydra, which is impossible. She seems to go mad, exclaiming that now the village will be threatened by mystical beasts. Nigen swears loudly, saying that the village is the closest to the deep forest, because it lies within Hydra's territory. Other monsters dared not approach because it was a white zone. Ayame angrily scolds her, asking if she knows about the villagers being sacrificed. Nigen, in a softer tone, says that Ayame only needs to defeat the enemy in front of him. But once he leaves, the villagers will suffer, they will no longer be able to live here. Nigen, with a darkened face, says she has the responsibility to protect her father's territory and do everything. When Nigen returns to stand in front of a mirror in her room, a person appears in the mirror, saying that Ayame is not a hero but a demon. The person in the mirror continues, saying that from the beginning, Ayame intended to take over this land. If she wants to protect her territory, the only way is to kill Ayame. Nigen laughs madly, saying she understands now, Shadow, she must go kill Ayame. As soon as Nigen leaves, Shadow in the mirror laughs loudly. Nigen came here in pure darkness, thankful that the heart of the weak is easily manipulated. The person in the mirror laughs, saying that soon the royal demon Shadow will take over Nigen's body. Ayame leaves Nigen's house and walks around the village asking about the demons, but everyone is too scared to say anything. He guesses that the villagers are very afraid of Nigen. Leaving that aside, thanks to Pina's skill inside her maze, they have helped the villagers grow many plants. The people, helped by Ayame, are astonished to see that they can harvest food from seeds in the blink of an eye. Ayame also helps them reinforce the walls. He looks at the wall, saying it's simple but should stop the demons from the land. Ayame smiles happily, looking at the man next to him, saying if there's anything he can help with, just ask. Ayame pleads with them not to give up, not to think about death but to try to live. Ayame bows his head to him, asking to be allowed to help everyone. The man laughs until tears form, surprised to hear such words again. He tells Ayame that the first time he heard those words was from the former lord of this land, Nigen's father. At that time, he had run to him, reporting that demons had surrounded the place. He also bore many wounds on his body. So he would rather stay in an alley than go out to fight and be eaten by them. At that time, he appeared, telling everyone not to give up. He couldn't help if everyone died. So, no matter how desperate, they must continue to live. He loudly said to survive and let him help. He recalls, still smiling, what an interesting person he was. He was a great man, always ready to face the demons. Even during the reign of previous lords, there were demon attacks, but it was never as bad as now. They never lacked food before. The situation worsened after the lord died and Miss Nigen took over. He can't forget when Hydra came, and instead of protecting the villagers, Miss Nigen went to make a pact herself. Nigen said that to achieve something, one must make sacrifices. And the price was the peace of this place. Nigen thought that this way, everyone wouldn't worry about the demons anymore and would be happy. The defensive capabilities of this place declined, and taxes were so heavy that people couldn't rebel. Those who couldn't endure went to Miss Nigen to protest or seek outside help, but none of them ever returned, and no one knew why. That's why no one dares to mention Miss Nigen anymore. But Nigen wasn't like this before, though her body was weak, her heart was incredibly kind. He laughs, telling Ayame he will call the villagers to fight again. He thanks Ayame for restoring his faith. After he leaves, Ayame speaks to Yuri and the others, saying something isn't right. The Nigen the villagers spoke of is completely different from the one they met. But they feel her desire to protect her territory is genuine. While everyone is still discussing, Ayame senses something unusual. Using his clairvoyant eye, he observes a horde of monsters approaching. Not far away, Nigen stands atop a tall building, silently laughing. The number of monsters is increasing to an uncountable amount. The villagers also start to notice and ask what that crowd is. They can't imagine what would happen if they were caught up in it. For the first time, Ursula panics, saying the walls won't be able to stop a crowd of over 1,000. As soon as they enter the village, it will be destroyed. Yuri, standing anxiously next to Ayame, asks what they should do now. The villagers wonder what has happened to the demons and if their lives are truly at an end. Ayn recalls Mia's innocent smile when she thanked him, and the trust of the man who just left. All these people need him. Ayn urges Yuri's group to quickly get inside his eyesight. Ayn vows that he will protect everyone's smiles at all costs. No matter if there are thousands or tens of thousands, he will wipe them all out. Ayn yells that he won't let them touch a single villager. Yuri worries that there are too many, she can't help him. Ayn has no choice but to use all his skills. The villagers watch, stunned, wondering how Ayn can handle so many demons. Pina worries that if he keeps fighting like this, he'll surely die. Ayn tells himself he can't fall until he's wiped them all out. Ursula is anxious, knowing that even if it's Ayn, continuously deploying the expansion target technique is extremely dangerous. Later, when Ayn reaches his limit, he still can't believe he's done it. Yuri runs over, worried, telling him not to speak and that she will heal him. Ursula scolds him loudly for what he's done, he's injured so badly that even the healing speed can't keep up. No one expected Ayn to defeat thousands of demons with his own strength. Ayn, relieved, thanks Yuri, saying the villagers are safe now. Mia's father is the first to run up and thank Ayn. He's like a god who has saved them twice. The man from earlier comes, standing outside, asking if everything is okay now. He yells that Ayn was injured like that just to protect strangers like them. Is it enough for them to just thank him after he fought to his last breath? He yells in the current situation, it looks like everyone is cursed. The truth is, everyone just sits there waiting for death, are they really okay with that? Someone quietly says it's because of the Lord. The man catches on to this, replying that's exactly why everyone gives up. Nothing will change even if they fight, he guesses that's what everyone is prepared to say. So that only hastens their death, next choosing who will be sacrificed. The young man shouts after seeing Ayn fight, asking how they could feel nothing. He lowers his voice, saying Ayn did all this just to protect their lives and dignity. The villagers then realize they too must stand up and fight with all their might. Everyone shouts even louder, determined to seize their future with their own hands. Yuri joyfully tells Ayn to look, everyone has regained their spirit. Finally, Ayn's efforts are rewarded. Ayn sits down, softly wondering if he is now closer to Yuri. He still remembers the first time he met Yuri, she saved him even though they were strangers. And since then, Yuri has given him so much, self-respect, confidence, courage, and boundless warmth. Ayn tells Yuri that if he could fully convey this feeling, it's like he's getting closer to her. Ayn is currently extremely happy. And partly because Ayn wants to experience the world Yuri sees. Not in front or behind, but standing beside her and viewing the same scene. Just as everyone is exhilarated, Naigen appears. She asks if everyone doesn't realize they are being deceived. She wants them to listen carefully, Ayn is the real demon. Naigen begins to loudly tell how Ayn defeated the SS-ranked Hydra and fought the demons alone. Normally, no one could do that, Ayn acted like a hero. Naigen, as if going mad, tells everyone not to worry, she will protect them. She promises to soon find a replacement like Hydra. She believes then everyone will understand why sacrifices are needed for peace. The people look at her, not understanding what she's saying. What about Ayn being a demon, wanting to continue controlling this place? But even if what Naigen says is true and Ayn is a demon, it's still 100 times better than the current situation. A villager steps up, asking Naigen if her talk of protecting the territory includes the people living here. The young man following Ayn steps up angrily, shouting about sacrificing for peace, saying he doesn't need it. Someone else scolds that even if one is a hypocrite, they shouldn't be someone who divides others. The young man yells loudly for peace without sacrifice. The person who will fight with them should be someone like her father. Naigen, clutching her head, kneels down and screams that no one believes her. She opens the mirror in her hand, pleading with Shadow to tell her what to do. Ayn observes Naigen and wonders what the mirror in her hand is, and what exactly is Shadow. He tries to appraise the mirror but fails. Ayn hears a voice saying his time has come and tries to stop Naigen from opening the mirror, but it's too late. Naigen, trapped in darkness, asks Shadow what she should do. Shadow tells her all she needs to do is follow his instructions. Her pain and fear will eventually be okay. Shadow simply suggests killing them all, saying he doesn't need those who disobey. Just kill them all, like he did with her father. Naigen, catching the essence of his words, asks if her father didn't die from illness. Shadow laughs loudly, saying he will show her the truth. Flashback to a day in Nigen's childhood. She happily brings tea to her father, asking him to take a break. Meanwhile, she overhears the peasants thanking the Lord for helping them with the fields. Her father modestly says he's just doing what should be done as someone living on this land. At that moment, Nigen saw her father as wonderful, humble, not arrogant, and loved by everyone. Since then, she has always wanted to be a great lord like her father. Nigen happily runs to help them in the fields but falls to the ground after a few steps. An old woman helps her up, noting her frail body. Her father comes over, caressing her head, saying children should play and have fun with friends. Nigen obediently follows her father's advice to find friends to play with. The village children, upon seeing her, say they know she's sick. Their mothers warn them not to play with her as they might catch the illness, and then they all run away. Nigen, saddened, insists it's not an illness, just that her body is a bit weak. On her way back, Nigen overhears a group discussing how great the Lord is, but they doubt Nigen's success with her frail body. They also mention a rumor that Nigen was adopted from the abyss, suggesting she's not a biological child. Hearing the words, adopted, Nigen is devastated, wondering if that's why she always messes things up. Nigen cries loudly, questioning why she is so weak and unable to be like her father. At that moment, a voice emanates from a puddle on the ground, telling her she doesn't need to be like that. The person in the water asks if she's tired of always comparing herself to others, saying that if she keeps comparing, she'll only lose confidence. She can do anything she wants as long as she remains true to herself. Thus, they become friends and keep the existence of this secret. One day, after her father returns exhausted from outside, Nigen runs to care for him. He tells her that he seems to have been exposed to too much demonic energy. After returning to her room, Nigen tells Shadow about her concerns for her father. Shadow suggests a herb that reduces fatigue and advises Nigen to brew some for her father. Following Shadow's instructions, she finds the revitalizing plant in a botanical book. The Lord feels much better after drinking it and thanks his daughter for her kindness. He sits down, caresses her head, and says she's very kind-hearted. He wants her to continue this way and someday she will become a great lord. However, her father's condition worsens over time. Nigen diligently prepares the herb for him to drink. Only today she learns it's a poisonous plant, with all parts being toxic. Nigen, refusing to believe it, accuses Shadow of lying. Shadow laughs loudly, revealing that the herb he gave her was indeed poison, magically altered by him. Shadow continues laughing, admitting that his statement about I'm being a demon was a lie. The real demon is himself. Shadow manipulated her father to create a path for humans to enter the demon world, but he refused. Unlike him, she was a valuable pawn, easily trusting due to their friendship. Shadow thanks Nigen, saying he can now lead many humans to the demon world. He mocks the situation, calling it a happy family where the foolish father is killed by his own child. He remarks it's interesting how, even though not blood-related, she resembles her beloved father. Shadow laughs loudly, declaring that she could never become a lord with her weak body and mind. Satisfied, he proclaims that they have finally become one. Shadow takes over Nigen's body and introduces himself to everyone as a level 5 member of the demon race. Ayn realizes that this wretched creature is using a cloaking technique to block his moves. Ayn sees that the body before him is no longer Nigen and asks Shadow where she is. Shadow, with disdain, says that due to her weakness, he easily took over her body after just a bit of shock. Shadow accuses Ayn of pretending to be hurt and blames everything on him. He reveals that he has been controlling Nigen from the shadows to weaken the defense of the territory. His only goal was to bring humans to the parallel demon world, but Ayn disrupted his plans. Shadow didn't expect things to turn out like this, calling it a hassle. He tells Ayn he's not as foolish as Falco, knowing precisely the weaknesses of humans, especially Ayn. Shadow bluntly states that if he dies, Nigen will surely die too. They start fighting, but Ayn can't use his full strength. He turns back to tell everyone to run away as the place is extremely dangerous. Numerous monsters summoned by Shadow appear. Shadow suddenly attacks Ayn, telling him to focus on fighting him. He mocks Ayn, saying becoming a true hero is really difficult. Ayn is at a loss, continuously trying to figure out how to avoid harming Nigen. Shadow laughs, asking Ayn if he's afraid to fight. He says if Ayn keeps thinking about protecting the villagers, he won't be able to do anything to him. To protect the village, he just needs to kill Shadow. Ayn, heartbroken, says he doesn't want to sacrifice one person to save 100. He never wants to abandon Nigen. Nigen, engulfed in darkness, wishes to disappear, feeling guilty for the pain she has caused to many. She believes someone weak like her shouldn't exist. At that moment, she hears Ayn's voice telling her not to hide anymore. Ayn continues shouting, saying her desire to protect the territory must not be a lie. He wants to know what makes her want to protect this place. As Nigen struggles within herself, the villagers outside are also fighting the monsters. They realize the eyes of the monsters are their weak points and aim their attacks there. They learn the truth that Nigen was being controlled by a demon named Shadow. However, they decided that they wouldn't abandon anyone, they had to fight. The man accompanying Ayn shouted to everyone that saving Nigen first would resolve everything. Everyone agreed, took up their weapons, and began to battle. Nigen knew she had done unforgivable things, but the deeds Shadow had done behind her back should have been known. It was hard to accept the truth, but if she couldn't break free now, she would never be able to move forward. As the lord of this place, she had to fulfill her responsibility. Shadow, sensing the danger, began to scream, telling her not to waste time fighting him. No matter how much she resisted, he wouldn't let her go. Nigen, after gaining control of her body, stabbed herself in the chest before Ayn could react. Shadow, in pain, asked if she wanted to die. Nigen replied that she knew he was not just a hallucination. But she pretended to be oblivious because she saw him as a friend. Even though Shadow had deceived and used her, turning her into the villain she is now, she still cared for him. Nigen burst into tears, admitting that while Shadow's words might have been lies, they saved her soul. For Nigen, the time spent beside him was not fake at all. Shadow laughed loudly, declaring her to be nothing more than a tool. He expressed his utter disgust at having to see Nigen's face. Weakness was a sin and the reason for her solitude. Shadow yelled that if she wanted to die, she should do it herself, then he left her body. Shadow laughed, planning to escape and start over. His next target was Mia, standing nearby. But to his surprise, he was stabbed with a sword before he could get close. After dealing with Shadow, Ayn rushed to check on Nigen's wounds. He insisted they must save her, praising Yuri's incredible healing powers. Yuri began examining Nigen, assuring that she could still hear them and would definitely come back. Gradually, Nigen regained consciousness, and both of them joyfully embraced her. In a weak voice, Nigen said she should have died. Ayn asked her if she didn't once want to sacrifice one to save 100 others, but for him, that would never happen. Ayn didn't want to leave anyone behind, including Nigen. Ayn's eyes filled with hatred as he thought about Zoid and now Nigen. He couldn't let demons exploit human weakness. He swore never to forgive them. Shadow, impaled by the sword, lay on the ground writhing, not wanting to die in this place. Alice approached him, questioning where he planned to escape to, then proceeded to create a barrier. Ayn approached Shadow, saying he had a question for him. Previously, a man named Falco had also come to kill him. Ayn wanted to know why they were after him and what their purpose was. Shadow arrogantly said that even if he knew, he wouldn't tell. Ayn calmly informed him that he would blow up the barrier. When Shadow, frightened, was about to reveal everything, he suddenly exploded. Ursula deduced that they must have implanted a self-destruct magic spell inside their bodies. The villagers rejoiced at Shadow's death. A man from the crowd came forward to thank Ayn profusely. It was because of him that they could take this next step. Nigen didn't know how to fully express her gratitude to Ayn but had a request. The next day, upon returning to meet the king, he offered Ayn a noble title as a reward, implying lordship over the territory. As for Nigen, she had surrendered and wanted to be tried for her crimes, wishing to support the territory from behind the scenes. The king, seeing Ayn's reluctance, added that he had helped the royal family prevent chaos. The royal family's reputation would be diminished if they didn't reward him appropriately for his great achievements. And of course, there would be many objections, which is why the king had called Ayn the demon slayer. Now, everyone would accept it as deserved. Ayn then remembered Nigen's request. She knew that more demons were appearing in the territory and only he could help fight them. Ayn had already decided to protect the place, but he hadn't expected to suddenly receive such a high position. With no other choice, Ayn accepted the noble title. In the demon world, although they had been defeated, the threat continued. The lesser demons couldn't believe that Falco and Shadow had been killed by a human. They couldn't accept their defeat to humans, tarnishing the demon realm's reputation, or rather, showing that the five demon realms weren't as significant as believed. Loanna, entering from outside, scolded the weak fools for just sitting around and gossiping, which she found most annoying. Upon meeting Echidone, she greeted the leader of the five noble demon realms. "Apologies for my tardiness, the vehicle malfunctioned again," said Echidone, looking at Ayn inside the sphere and laughing heartily, as she had expected. Loanna, puzzled, asked if she was interested in him. Indeed, he was a boy with unique eyes but still just a human. She couldn't believe that a human could kill Falco and Shadow. It wasn't just luck, it was skill twice over. Echidona wanted Loanna to kidnap a World Tree Spirit. Then Ayn would automatically come to them seeking the World Tree Spirit, and they wouldn't need to capture him. Alice found Ayn and said she had some things to discuss. She seriously talked about establishing a timeline and information on the remaining World Trees. Alice also expressed her desire to reunite with her sisters. Everyone was joyful and thankful to Alice. Alice mentioned it wasn't just a discovery, but a necessity. Yuri asked what she meant, and Pien admitted his confusion about these complexities. Ayn asked if anyone else heard a different sound while they were talking. Crush appeared, smiling, saying she had been discovered. Pina, seeing her sister, ran to her joyfully, revealing that she was their second sister. Ayn was surprised that a spirit could come here on her own. Crush explained the real reason for her visit. The demons were targeting the World Trees, and she needed Ayn's help. They were trying to hold off, but the enemy might be stronger than anticipated. Ayn immediately agreed to help but asked where Crush's World Tree was. Crush said they weren't targeting her, but May's World Tree. Yuri laughed, saying May was their youngest sister and very adorable. Alice mentioned that while researching the Lestic territory, she discovered Abyss had found May's World Tree, which seemed to have a hidden labyrinth. Ayn guessed May's guardian was doing their best, but Crush interjected that May's guardian had long been sacrificed. The World Trees were valuable magical resources, so many sought to seize them at any cost. That's why Crush took it upon herself to protect May. Ayn thought Crush was just a spirit, and spirits couldn't leave their World Trees. Alice informed him that the three Elder Great Spirits had the ability to act independently. So, they can move freely to some extent. Ayn understood that currently, Crush was protecting May while she was hiding in a forest labyrinth. The demons came again, wanting to kidnap May. Crush laughed, appreciating Yuri's companion's quick grasp. Crush informed everyone that her presence here was just a copy. Her main body was protecting May, but she couldn't hold on much longer. Alice asked if the enemies were so strong that Crush's evil eye couldn't harm them. Crush admitted that she couldn't exert her full power without risking May's tree and territory being destroyed. Ayn realized that's why she always kept her eyes sealed with a cloth. He assured her that he would go there to protect them, so they needed to hold on a bit longer. Crush smiled, noting her sister's fondness for Ayn. She left, saying that since Alice knew the location, she would wait for everyone to come and save her adorable younger sister. When Ayn entered the hidden dungeon, he encountered demons waiting there. Ayn knew he couldn't underestimate the demons, not even for a moment. A half-human, half-bee demon laughed, releasing numerous other bees. No one could stand against such a swarm. It mocked Ayn for his arrogance in defeating Falco and Shadow. The demon was delighted to see the bees surrounding Ayn in the middle, but suddenly realized Ayn had disappeared. Ayn appeared unexpectedly behind her, declaring he couldn't show mercy to demons. The bee demon protested, questioning why he would attack a weak woman from behind. Unfortunately for Ayn, her ability was manipulation. With her inherent pheromones, she could freely control her kind. She laughed, enjoying being surrounded by children willing to die for her. Amidst a large swarm of bees, she challenged Ayn to find out which one she really was. If he couldn't, he wouldn't be able to win. She boasted that just her bees alone would be enough to defeat him. Ayn coldly stated that it didn't matter who she was, as he would exterminate them all. Ursula informed him that she had identified the core of their group, so he should just go ahead and kill them. The bee demon, shocked, asked if Ayame was joking, but then, realizing her bees were being annihilated, she panicked. She opened her mouth wide, shocked that Ayame had effortlessly destroyed all her S-rank bee descendants. Realizing the situation was hopeless, she decided that fleeing was the best option. Loanna caught her, asking if she was trying to run away. The bee demon loudly claimed it wasn't because of her weakness, but because Ayame was too strong, and she would plan better next time. Loanna crushed her mercilessly, stating there's no chance for such trash. Loanna sighed, tired of dealing with such rubbish, especially the stupidity of her kind, which was not like before. Loanna approached Ayame and introduced herself as the leading duchess of the demon race. She continued, saying Ayame might lack magical skills but had detected her energy, calling him exceptionally talented. Although subduing these monkeys was the job of the lower demons, Loanna was intrigued enough to kill Ayame and capture the spirits. Ayame shouted, outraged that her target was not just him but also the spirits, and that was unforgivable. Loanna laughed, asking what Ayame planned to do, as he immediately began absorbing levels and relentlessly attacked her. Loanna, amused by the pain, commented that it had been a long time since someone made her bleed like that. Soon, Loanna realized something was wrong, her powers weren't working, she couldn't even dodge simple attacks, and eventually, Ayame decapitated her. Ayame told her that he didn't just use his absorption skill once but throughout the fight, making her as weak as level 1 creeps. Loanna, knowing she had no chance of fighting back, crawled away with her severed head to escape. After resolving the trouble, Ayame began searching for the entrance to the world tree. He discovered an incredibly solid wall, sure that they were inside. Ayame looked at the wall and turned to the others, questioning if it wasn't too obvious. Alice explained that it was covered by spirit magic, invisible to the naked eye. Ayame realized he could see it because he possessed Yuri's eyes. Ursula commented that although Loanna couldn't see the wall, she seemed to sense its presence and kept attacking it, but fortunately, the wall was unaffected by her strikes. Ayame, puzzled, wondered how they would enter now. Alice pointed to a spot where the tree was gradually opening a pathway. Crush stood inside waiting for them, saying she had waited a long time. Ayame was surprised by the bright surroundings, despite being underground. Crush laughed, calling the girls her little ones. Pina was the first to run over, and they performed a series of hand gestures together. Ayame, feeling dizzy, wondered what they were doing. Alice explained that it was a recognition sign between the two and added that they were called the unstable duo because of their shared interests. Hearing this, Crush playfully asked Alice if she wanted to join their duo. Alice, expressionless, questioned what they were doing. To break the awkwardness, Ayame expressed his relief that Crush was safe but then asked about May. Ayame was taken to where little May was sleeping and was surprised by how small she was. Thinking not to disturb the sleeping child, he was about to leave when May suddenly started crying. Ayame was startled, insisting he hadn't done anything to her. Seeing Yuri, May ran into her arms and pulled out a flower crown she had made, saying she had intended to give it to them when they arrived, but fell asleep before finishing it. Yuri sat down, thanked her, and placed the crown on May's head, complimenting how beautiful she looked with it. May beamed, asking if she looked pretty. Ayame, standing next to Yuri, was glad she had stopped crying. Suddenly, May loudly told Yuri to stay away from Ayame, calling him a bad person, having heard the commotion outside earlier. Yuri smiled, explaining to her sister that Ayame was a good person who had driven the bad people away. Reassured, May ran to Ayane's feet, apologizing for her misunderstanding. During the cheerful moment, Crush mentioned that May wanted to join them on their journey. She smiled at everyone, saying it would be fine, and that she respected May's decision, leaving herself in charge of caring for the world tree. Ayame asked Crush if she didn't want to join them, clarifying that he wanted to know what she wanted to do, not what she had to do, respecting her decision just as she did May's. He continued, asking if Crush also wanted to join them. Crush laughed, praising Ayame as an excellent assessor, noting that he could assess not just skills but also the emotions deep in one's heart. Ayame replied that she was too kind, but he thought the world tree would be fine. To be sure, he would place a barrier and a clone of himself there to be ready for any situation. Crush thanked Ayame and handed him the core spirits of herself and May. After doing so, Crush ran over to her sisters, announcing her decision with a laugh. Ayn sat down with Mei, assuring her that he would protect her world tree and that she didn't need to worry. Once everything was settled, Ayn stepped back to stand next to Ursula, watching everyone happily. He confided in her that finally, the five of them could be together. Ursula agreed that it would indeed be lively from now on. With only three more to go, she believed Ayn would make it. Ayn whispered that he always hated himself, but meeting Yuri and the others, he wanted to protect, support, and make them laugh always. He felt warmth from them and, being with them, felt a strength from deep within his heart. Finally, he had come to accept himself. Ayn was proud to be able to protect their smiles, wanting to maintain this spirit and walk proudly. Realizing he had spoken a lot, he laughed, saying he got overly sentimental. He felt he could share anything with Ursula, perhaps because she was his mentor. Ursula, after a pause, asked for the spirit cores. She explained that Crush's void eye would make everything Ayn saw become indeterminate, erasing the existence of the object, thus consuming a lot of magic power and putting immense pressure on the eyes. However, since Ayn had the holy eye, he needn't worry about blindness, though she wasn't sure about other side effects, advising not to overuse it. Then Mei demonstrated her control over the creation tree with her bare hands, saying it should only be used in desperate situations. Ursula praised this as excellent, explaining that aura is an energy that drifts in nature and can become a powerful source when combined to become more advanced. She noted that Loanna underestimated Ayn and hence didn't use this. Ayn, surprised, asked if that meant Loanna wasn't really serious in their confrontation. Not entirely, Ayn's spirit sword has destructive power. It can cut through demons and absorb their negative aura. Ayn laughed, saying that now he could directly confront them. After finishing their journey, Ayn's group went to Nigan's mansion, which they had previously stayed in, to clean up and prepare for moving to a new residence. Ayn allocated rooms for everyone and finally completed his part. Going to check on everyone's progress, he met Yuri, who was stunningly dressed, coming down from the upstairs. She explained that after cleaning up, they had prepared a party for Crush and Little Mei. So, she borrowed a dress from the upstairs dressing room. Ayn said he would go get ready to join everyone, but Yuri stopped him, mentioning that everything was prepared and that the party was also a surprise for Ayn. When Ayn entered the party room, it was like stepping into a fairy tale world, with everyone looking incredibly beautiful. Pina brought Ayn a new outfit, urging him to change into it. Ayn emerged looking completely different from usual. Yuri complimented him, saying he looked like he stepped out of a fairy tale. Ayn thanked everyone for choosing the outfit for him and expressed his gratitude to Crush for everything she had done, asking her to enjoy the party. Crush laughed, assuring she was fully enjoying herself. Yuri happily thanked Ayn, saying it was because of him that everyone could meet and thanked him for everything. Ayn smiled along with everyone, saying that when they are together, tomorrow will be happier than today, and so on for all the tomorrows to come. Jasper arrived the next day with things for Ayn. Ayn apologetically thanked him for carrying so much stuff. Jasper noticed that Ayn's eyes seemed brighter, perhaps due to a new spirit core. Ayn glossed over the compliment and introduced Jasper to the new arrivals. Then they discussed business, ensuring the safety of people in remote areas in the future. Jasper's Silver Phoenix Trading Company had decided to provide support by sending people to supply food and medical care. There was also a Lord's meeting today, which Jasper would attend on Ayn's behalf. Ayn apologized, admitting he wasn't good at such things. Jasper, before leaving, assured Ayn he was doing it because he wanted to. When Jasper left, Mei and Pina couldn't help but admire him, calling him a man of work, intelligent and thoughtful. Ayn felt disheartened, saying he could do nothing but fight. Yuri came close to Ayn, comforting him that he was also very diligent. Pina humorously asked Ayn if he knew the saying right person, right time, emphasizing the importance of relying on others when needed. Alice, who rarely spoke, advised Ayn to just do what he was capable of. Ayn loudly rallied everyone to go to the village and do whatever they could to help the villagers. Action, he said, was better than sitting idle and worrying. The village had become livelier, thanks to him, and the villagers' smiles had returned. Meeting Ayn again, they had a request for him. They wanted him to teach them how to fight, to help if monsters returned. Ayn started their training with running exercises. The villagers were surprised, asking if that was all, expecting something more like punching and kicking. Ayame explained that running helps build overall muscle strength, making it an effective exercise for basic physical training. The villagers realized the wisdom in this and praised Ayame for his intelligence. Cody, standing among the crowd, loudly denounced the idea of Ayame being a dragon-slaying hero. He accused Ayame of looking down on the villagers now that he was a lord and doubted Ayame's rapid increase in strength, suspecting a hidden secret. A man frequently with Ayame approached to apologize to him. Ayame reassured him, saying he had experienced such things before. The man explained that Cody's parents were killed by demons when he was young, and after leaving to become a royal adventurer, he returned to abuse and not help with the reconstruction, uncaring about others' struggles. The man angrily stated that Cody had no right to say those things. Ayame consoled him, thinking Cody would just come to mock for a while and then leave when bored. Ayame then loudly told everyone to start training. He would lead by running ahead of everyone. Cody secretly thought that he would definitely surpass Ayame. Everyone around at that time was astonished, looking at Ayame and asking, "Are you jogging?" Ayame's body moved smoothly without any superfluous movement. It didn't seem like he was using any skills or magic. This kind of ability doesn't just come from a day or two of learning, it's as if he had undergone training hundreds of thousands of times. Cody knew he couldn't keep up at this level. Ayame told Ursula that he had already slowed down his pace, yet others still couldn't catch up. Pina replied that Ayame was the strange one. Up until now, he had fought many enemies, and his body might have leveled up to that of a hero. Ayame realized that his physical condition had improved without him noticing. An hour of jogging passed, and everyone directly collapsed on the ground. Yuri came to restore everyone, saying they had worked hard. Ayame called Cody, who was standing aside, to come for recovery with everyone else, but he flatly refused. Ayame led everyone to the second phase, getting accustomed to chasing monsters. Seeing everyone worried, Ayame advised them not to worry as Yuri would heal them if they got injured. Kuro said Ayame was unconsciously very similar to Ursula. Meanwhile, Cody, not wanting to train with others, went into the forest alone. He encountered an S-level one-eyed demon and wanted to run away in fear. But, he eventually stopped to carry out a dark plot. Cody found a stone and threw it at the monster, attracting a crowd to chase after it. He wanted to teach Ayame a lesson but didn't expect to be the one in danger. Cody tried to flee but encountered little Mia gathering herbs. He got delayed trying to save her and was attacked by the monsters. Luckily, Ayame, realizing the situation, arrived just in time to rescue them. When only the two of them were left, Cody asked Ayame why he saved him. Ayame casually told him that his parents also died when he was young. That's why he wanted to become an adventurer to make a living and endure the contempt like what Cody was going through. Moreover, Ayame noticed that Cody had led the monsters in the opposite direction to protect the villagers. After listening to Ayame for a while, Cody burst into tears, calling him Big Brother, and promising to follow Ayame for life. Recently, Ayame had always been paying attention to Ursula's complexion, feeling that she was not okay, as if enduring some pain. Hearing this, Ursula immediately replied that she did not have such a hobby. Ayame sat on the ground, looking up at Ursula, wanting her to share the difficulties she was facing. Just like how she once helped him, he now wanted to do the same for her. Ursula, agitated, yelled that if he really wanted to help, he should leave her alone. Saying this, she walked away, ignoring the others who were watching her. Yuri was worried, not knowing what problems her mother was facing. Kuro told her not to worry and that she would go talk to her mother. Ayame apologized to everyone for not being able to help. Kuro softly said that Ayame's kindness had already helped a lot. Ayame thought to himself that if it were Kugo, he might have an easier time talking to Ursula than he did. Kuro, trying to lift Ayame's spirits, wished him luck with his lordship duties. Ayame knew he had to do everything he could. Once Ursula was better, he was determined to make her proud of him. Ursula, hiding beneath the world tree, kept drinking without stopping. She thought to herself like a fool, feeling utterly ashamed. Ursula considered passing the guardian role to Ayame. Since birth, she had been bestowed by the gods with the profession of sage, allowing her to cast magic without reading the scriptures. Her friends and parents hailed her as a prodigy, but she always felt an emptiness inside. Ursula constantly wondered why she had this power and what its purpose was. Then, one day, 9 sages were summoned to receive orders from the queen to split a branch of the world tree into 9 cores. Ursula was overjoyed, her long-standing emptiness dissipated. She finally understood why she was born, it was all to protect the world tree. But those peaceful days didn't last long when demons appeared and infiltrated the labyrinth. Since meeting Ayn, Yuri's destiny began to change. According to Ursula, Ayn was a pitiful person, pushed into the abyss just because of his lowly profession. Ayn grew step by step, deserving to be a guardian. Ayn had changed his fate and became even stronger than Ursula. Kuro and Ursula had an argument when they met. Ursula insisted that as Yuri's mother, she had to live to protect her daughter. Kuro argued that even if they were parents and children, everyone should have their own life. Ursula burst into tears, wondering what she had left in the end, and what it would be like if she gave up that responsibility. Kuro spoke softly, advising Ursula not to depend on the purpose given by the goddess. She suggested that when Ursula is no longer a guardian, she should do what she wants, live a life without obligations or responsibilities. Kuro wanted Ursula not to suppress her emotions too much and to cry out loud if she felt like it. Ursula realized that she had been too preoccupied with Yuri and had neglected her own feelings. She needed to answer the question of what she truly wanted to do. Once she had her answer, she would hand over her position to Ayn. At the castle of the demon lord, the demons had gathered for a meeting to discuss eliminating Ayn and seizing his territory. The demons kept talking nonsense, which annoyed Loanna. She quietly scolded them for being too noisy and not to infect her with their stupidity. Echidona announced that the purpose of this gathering was solely about Ayn, who was causing a stir. She wanted to share some information, which was why she had invited everyone. Gorman, looking at Ayn's reflected image, cursed him as the brat who killed Falco and Shadow, looking utterly disgusting. Suddenly remembering something, Gorman stood up and said that there was someone shameful who shouldn't be there. Shouldn't they deal with Loanna first? Loanna, angered, asked what he meant. Gorman laughed louder, saying she knew best, didn't she? The shame of losing to a mere human was not at all perfect. Loanna insisted she didn't lose but wasn't serious that day. Her powers had now returned and were even stronger than before. The other demons began to laugh at how she could lose to a human. Loanna, furious, wanted to take each of their lives. Echidona called for everyone to calm down, reminding them they were on the same team. In her anger, Loanna unintentionally pushed Echidona away, telling her not to touch her. Gorman, enraged, grabbed Loanna, saying he didn't care if she failed or lost. But if she continued to talk to Echidona like that, it wouldn't end well with everyone here. Loanna, realizing she had gone too far, softened her tone and asked Echidona for another chance, promising to surely take Ayn's life this time. Echidona agreed but wanted her to make sure she could bring Ayn's life back. Gorman spoke up, asking to join in, as he couldn't be at ease leaving it all to Loanna. With a menacing face, Gorman wondered aloud how a milk-smelling boy would fare when facing a demon. At the Lestic Territory training camp, the villagers wondered if they had really become stronger. Their training involved only running, fighting monsters, and more running. Cody, replacing Ayn in managing the village, constantly urged everyone to train diligently. Suddenly, a portal from the demon world opened, and numerous demons along with Gorman appeared. Gorman looked around and noted that this was Ayn's territory. A boy from the village, in panic, flailed his arms and legs, unsure of what to do. Accidentally bumping into a demon, to his surprise, he shattered it. The villagers started cheering, saying their hard training under the Big Brother paid off, and that they were right to trust him. They tried to use what Ayn taught them to fight the demons, but before they could act, Gorman killed those demons himself, astonishing everyone. He declared that he didn't need useless beings, and trash should be disposed of. A fearless boy ran up, wanting to fight Gorman, claiming that he was strong enough to crush even a demon. However, he ended up being seriously injured. Seeing how Gorman fought, Cody realized that he was no ordinary foe. Crush stepped forward, wanting to fight Gorman herself. Cody, in fear, urged her to step back, warning that Gorman was a type of demon that manipulates the undead. He worried about what he would say to Ayn if something happened to her. Crush assured him it was fine and told him to leave everything to her. Despite her appearance, she was in a difficult position. Crush announced that she could no longer hold back and ordered Cody to quickly take everyone to safety, as far away as possible. Following her instructions, Cody quickly led everyone to a safe place. The villagers worriedly watched Crush, about to fight. Cody comforted them, saying she was confident in her victory, so their task was to trust her completely. Staying there would only hinder her. Gorman noticed that Crush was different from the humans he had just encountered, especially in terms of her terrifying power. He mocked the idea of another power explosion but didn't see it as a problem, confident that he would handle it easily. His plan was to control this territory perfectly and then go after Ayn. He guessed that this was the time Loanna was facing Ayn, so he needed to clean up quickly. He couldn't let Loanna easily take the credit. Gorman laughed arrogantly, proclaiming that he would excellently complete the task he was given. Gorman told her to look carefully at the perfect masterpiece created from the corpses scattered throughout the forest. Crush said she didn't want to use this power at all, but it was him who forced her. In a moment, all of Gorman's monsters vanished. He shouted in disbelief, questioning how they could just disappear. Crush calmly said that she had accidentally obliterated them, or more accurately, they never existed. Gorman, in fear, asked if that was the atheist eye. She looked at him and said his power seemed to be at an absolute stable level, but she preferred something with a little flaw. Indeed, Gorman did not allow anything less than perfect. He had a family that loved him very much, but his parents were not perfect at all. If he killed them off, he could create another pair of perfect parents. Since then, everything for him had been utterly perfect. Gorman laughed, saying now a perfect death would only add to the beauty. On the other side, Ayn let everyone go home early today because of an uninvited guest. When everyone left, he said she could come out now. Loanna appeared, thanking Ayn for playing with her the other day. Ayn curiously asked why she didn't attack the villagers while she was there. He thought demons always attacked innocent people. Loanna told him that such despicable acts were only done by lowly demons. She wanted just the two of them, this time believing he wouldn't have time for assessment or defenses. Loanna was astonished when her move was blocked. Why did I know such a technique? When she realized Ayn could use aura, her head was once again severed from her neck. Loanna screamed that only demons like them were supposed to use it. Ayn replied it was just like spirit magic, he just unconsciously used it. Loanna couldn't accept her defeat. She suddenly called out to Lady Echidona. Echidona appeared, asking if she had lost again, saying she knew it would happen. At this moment, Ayn thought why the name sounded so familiar.